Education is an academic holocaust. The Board of Education is an academic holocaust. All right, brothers, sisters, let's settle down. Say shalom to the brothers and to the sisters and to those of you online. Pray that y'all made it through the snowstorm. I see that y'all did. I'm glad you did. Today's topic, we're going to deal with the Board of Education is an academic holocaust. The Board of Education is an academic holocaust. That's what we're going to discuss today. New York City is about to get a new school chancellor. Many people are concerned about it. To me, it makes no difference who he or she is. It may be someone named, what was her name? Damn. What's the lady's name? It's either my old lady. No, it's an old lady. She's 70 years old. I can't remember her name. All right, the structure of the United States educational system, its curriculum, its content, its standards were developed by middle-aged white supremacists. I'm going to say it again. The structure of the United States educational system, its curriculum, its content, standards were developed by middle-aged white supremacists. Their teachers, their school administration, their educational experts, they will all have their foundation in white supremacy. I'm going to show you, I'm going to open up with an article. All right, this is under the American Thinker. This was September 10th of this year. We're not going to read the whole thing. I'm just going to read from this top. The Racist Propaganda Conference for Teachers. Listen good. For those of you that really entrust your children into the United States school system. It says from April 13th to April 16th, the Lakesville School District in Minnesota is sending its teachers to the 12th annual White Privilege Conference. Yes, it is as bad as it sounds. To quote the article, the conference is built on the premise that the United States was started by white people for white people. Its mission is to get participants to confront their biases and a journey in understanding white supremacy, whiteness, privilege, power, and oppression. And to agree, see, this is an article. Y'all really got to read the news, see what's happening out there. And to agree to take action in their own circle of power. That means white folks. At workshops, participants will discuss how white privilege, white supremacy, and oppression affects daily life. This seems pretty straightforward. The premise is that all white people are bad. I wonder why this isn't called the Racist Propaganda Conference instead. Of course, they would never admit that that is what they are doing. Leftists never do. They would just claim that they are just trying to make people aware of differences. So I'm gonna end. I want to end it there. Go back, pull out so we can see the article. Go back. Now, I'm going to show you one of the side effects of that. I'm going to go to the next article with the Native American Indian. This is the family here. This is the family. Husband and wife, four kids and a dog. They're Native Americans. I forgot what tribe they're from. Let's read down. Okay. Jen Eagle Bull, that's their name, Oxendine, and James Oxendine are shown here with their four children, Jace Masty, 5, Jada Sitch, 7, Jake, 13, Kasky, 15. After taking a stand against their children's school stereotype-laden Thanksgiving curriculum, the family says Jada's scholarship was revoked as retribution. School officials deny this. Now let's read the article. Family stands against school's racist Thanksgiving curriculum. Now, y'all know here in New York, every year we got to take our kids out of school because they have this Thanksgiving celebration. A lot of you don't see that as racist. It is racism. It is all based on white supremacy. It says, the Oxendine family have long valued how Montessori schools educated their four children, especially with Montessori's stated principles of inclusiveness and compassion. They were, thus, thrilled when their youngest children, Jada, 7, and Jace, 5, received scholarships in 2012 to the Maria Montessori School in San Diego due to their family's Native American and military backgrounds. But now, the Oxendines say an ongoing conflict over the school's problematic, now canceled Thanksgiving curriculum has led to the revoking of Jada's scholarship, something school officials deny. Go up. Okay. Red flags were raised in early November 2012. This is last year. I mean, 2 years ago. This is 2014. Yeah, year before last. All right. Red flags were raised in early November of 2012 when they learned the school was planning Thanksgiving classroom activities, encouraging students to dance around teepees, dress up as Indians with headbands of multicolored feathers, and give each other Indian names. Whenever we go back to the Pine Ridge Reservation where my wife is from, the children are surrounded by ceremonies and dances. They're taught feathers are sacred and only for ceremonies, said James Oxendine, Lumbee. Lumbee, an information systems officer in the United States Navy, and it was confusing for them to see the school doing it differently and perpetuating stereotypes in this way. Woo, woo, you know, they're going around, woo, 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 all of that. Some of y'all did it. I know I did it. After receiving a newsletter describing the week of potentially offensive activities, his wife, Jean Eagle Bull Oxendine, Oglala Sue, decided to try to engage the school in creating a culturally appropriate curriculum. What followed is in dispute. School officials say they immediately ended the curriculum and have tried to cooperate with the Oxendines. But the Oxendines say the school resisted ending their Thanksgiving tradition. I believe that one. The school resisted ending their Thanksgiving tradition and told them to keep their kids at home because that's what they tell me. So I believe that one. Told them to keep their kids at home rather than change the curriculum and eventually revoke their daughter's scholarship to be rid of their complaints. They said they were doing these activities to honor us, Native Americans, but then they wanted us to stay home while they were honoring us, said Eagle Bull Oxendine. The family has posted a change.org petition demanding the school issue an apology, reinstate their daughter's scholarship, and implement the National Museum of the American Indians holiday curriculum. Dina Stoneman, co-director of the school, said the petition is misleading for many reasons, including that it makes readers think the school is still conducting the same Thanksgiving curriculum this year. It saddens us that they're using this platform for personal gain when they should be using it to promote Native American rights and how to correctly teach about Native Americans, Stoneman said. She described the rich curriculum as being developed to teach students about how many different Native American tribes have lived in the past and now in the present day. Once they learned the use of the feathers were offensive, they dropped the curriculum and invited Eagle Bull Oxendine to do a presentation and even start a diversity committee, Stoneman said. Stoneman also said the Oxendines disenrolled their daughter when she couldn't guarantee them that no children would wear their headbands with feathers to school. Now you see that? So in other words, they can't, listen, some kids might do it anyway. Because you know white folks, they don't give a damn what our people think. Stoneman also said that the Oxendines disenrolled their daughter when she couldn't guarantee them that no children would wear their headbands with feathers to school. The scholarship money had already been allocated to another student When the Oxendines tried to re-enroll her, she said. See, now that all that's a lie. I know that's a lie. I know white folks. They lie. This year, Stoneman said they are asking students and families to celebrate at home because they have the week off. The Oxendines, however, say the school continued with the curriculum last year, but only announced its cancellation this year. So see, more lies. Eagle Bull Oxendine said when she tried to raise the issue with the directors of the school, she was told students would be too disappointed if they weren't allowed to have their Thanksgiving traditions. Let's translate. What does that mean? Well, who is she talking about? White folks, white kids, and their parents. We need, all of us, we need, from state to state, need to pull our kids out on them holidays. All of them. Just pull our kids out. Get our own schools. Where am I? The Oxendines, however, say the school continued with the curriculum last year and only announced its cancellation this year. Eagle Bull Oxendine said when she tried to raise the issue with the directors of the school, she was told students would be too disappointed if they weren't allowed to have their Thanksgiving tradition. And that, you know what? Dumb black kids, too. They're being there. Well, we just thanking God for, you know, the dumb black parents. I just want to thank God for, black people make dumb stuff up. We hear y'all on the street. It says, then when she tried to approach the parent liaison about the issue, she was told her children would be disenrolled if she continued to raise the issue. In other words, you better calm down, nigga. You better calm yourself down. The Oxendines said they made a quick decision to try to enroll Jada in public school, fearing she would miss the rest of the term if she was kicked out of Maria Montessori. They changed their mind a couple of days later and were shocked to learn their daughter's scholarship had so quickly been given to another student. You go through a lot of emotions, Eagle Bull Oxendine said. Rosa Parks didn't stop riding the bus because she didn't have the front seat. Our daughter has every right to attend on that scholarship. Currently, Jada is being homeschooled, her parents said, and she has suffered some psychological effects from what happened. This, you know why? Because she believed all white people was nice. Their son is still at Maria Montessori, and the Oxendines say they have been impressed with his teacher. Their main issue is with the school's administration, they say. We want to raise awareness that no classroom activity should make a mockery of our culture. Eagle Bull Oxendine said, we're doing this for Jada, but we're also doing it for all Native children. So now people posted their comments up. All right. Now, what I want to show y'all is a video clip. Now, this is about, the video is about a black, I don't even know if she's black, but a little girl got beat up by cops. The little girl has diabetes, but that is not the focal point of what I want y'all to pay attention to. I want y'all to listen to what he says about the schools. Everybody with me so far? I need y'all to pay attention. A lot of y'all who are young, y'all gonna have kids soon. Y'all, what we're going over, be aware of this.
From Alternet, diabetic high school girl beaten by police officer and arrested for falling asleep in class. Yeah. How the hell does this happen? And what does this say about the racist policies of our government when it takes on the system of government-run education centers or public schools, as they're euphemistically referred to, when they're really just, you know, conditioning and propaganda centers?
Stop. You heard what he said? Called schools conditioning propaganda centers. He called school. Now, this is so-called Jew. Amalek. That's Amalek. He calls the school system, what did he say? Conditioning propaganda centers. Now you gotta ask yourself, why do I find that striking? Because these people do not send their kids to our, what we call our schools. And you always wonder why do they separate their kids from where our kids go? Because they know that the public school system is nothing but conditioning propaganda centers.
While she was reading Huckleberry Finn, she dozed off. Come on, it's a good book, but you know, when you force a kid to read something that they're not, you know, engaged in and wanting to learn, it's gonna be boring.
Who knows about, I had to read Huckleberry Finn. Huckleberry Finn was written by who? Mark Twain. That is a racist Edomite. All you read the word nigga all through the book. What was his best friend's name? Nigga. yeah, was it Tom Sawyer? The, Huck Finn and Tom Sawyer, it's all racist. That's why at the beginning of the lesson, when I said what I said, I know what I'm talking about. The whole school system is based on white supremacy.
It's gonna, you know, it's gonna be really hard to inspire in like real intellectual engagement. This is why unschooling or self-guided learning is so superior to this. And when you understand that, you understand like what the education racket really represents. You see like why there's an incentive for the government to take over education, not just because it's one of the planks of the Communist Manifesto, but because they want to keep you from being free on your own to prosper as an individual, as an entrepreneur of your own life. They want you to be a good little wage slave. They want to prepare you for that life as a propagandized citizen.
He's letting you know that the school system was not created for our kids to become entrepreneurs. It's for you to be in a damn, like a factory. You come off the factory line and you're meant just to uphold the system. Go play it back.
It's gonna, you know, it's gonna be really hard to inspire in like real intellectual engagement. This is why unschooling or self-guided learning is so superior to this. And when you understand that, you understand like what the education racket really represents. You see like why there's an incentive for the government to take over education, not just because it's one of the planks of the Communist Manifesto, but because they want to keep you from being free on your own to prosper as an individual, as an entrepreneur of your own life. They want you to be a good little wage slave. They want to prepare you for that life as a propagandized citizen. They want you to be dead. They want you to sit in cemetery row seating. That's what they call it. They want to kill that which is most essential to human life, the exercise of your will.
Oh, yeah.
Pause it. Wait.
This is why your kids come out dumb. All these kids here that go to these schools, our kids dumb as hell. They cannot measure up to the white kids in private school or these other schools. I'm sorry, mothers. That's the reality of it. That's what the devil himself is letting you know. These kids are ill-prepared for life, every last one of them, including mine.
Do y'all hear the words that's being said by this man? This man is saying something like enroll cemeteries. He's saying stuff like propaganda centers. He's saying a lot of stuff. He is saying a lot of stuff. And I believe it's going over a lot of people's heads.
Yeah.
I really don't think that a lot of people are catching what's being said up here.
The key word is conditioning.
Right.
That's the key word that we're leaving out. It's conditioning. School is conditioning now.
When it comes to business and so forth, Amalek, all right, they young kids is the ones that lead in heart surgery, that lead in get their own business set up and so forth. And we are the ones that go and work for them.
Yep.
You know, they are the ones that making most of the money. That's real brilliant. And this one, he got this one, this Jake, that think he's a Hamite. Some of you have probably saw the video where he said, listen, the so-called Jewish people is being blessed. That's God blessing them because they own in the business and they own all the wealth and all of that. But it's not the Most High blessing them. It's because they got an advantage over us.
Right.
All right. They got an advantage over us when it comes to education and so forth. So that's what it is.
You know, one of the main points that I'm picking up from all of this is the reason why we are oblivious to all of this stuff that's going on is because we have allowed someone else to define who we are. In other words, when he speaks about his people are not getting caught up in this. Why? Because they make their own image of themselves. Other people, they make their own image of themselves. We depend on others to tell us how we should be. You follow me? That's where the conditioning comes in. And we're not even cognizant of that.
Activists have long decried the, quote, school-to-prison pipeline, which disproportionately affects communities of color. Now, it's not just the school-to-prison pipeline, and it's certainly true that it conditions you, institutionalizes you to be comfortable in such an environment or to see that as normal, but even if it's not school-to-prison, it's school to the prison that is the average American life of being a boring wage slave. I mean, you want to sit at home, live your boring bitch life, fine, you know? But if you ever want to step up and ask, how did I get here? Maybe looking back at how you were conditioned as a high school student when you were doing the government's bidding every single day might offer some clues.
That stuff went over. Could you play
school to prison pipeline? Conditioning people of color, meaning blacks and, because he says it later on, he specifies blacks and Latinos go from school to prison. He said that's what schools prepare you for. And to be a wage slave means that minimum wage that the vast majority of our people are under.
In other words, when you put the finishing touches on these major universities, your business school of business and all of that, and you've laid it out, none of you go into business. None of you do anything for your people. You all, the majority of us go right back and join the wage force, just like if anybody else. That's the point I make. When you look at, I'll give an example. Here's what points to it perfectly. Hold it. Let me show you what points to it perfectly. When you have black folk in America, just black people, I ain't even hit the other tribes yet, just black folk. Black folk. $1 trillion being spent outside of the black community. $1 trillion. That is some amazing money that's being spent. And out of all of that money that's being spent, not any of it is reciprocated to build something, an infrastructure to take care of our homeless, to take care of the people, to take care of the sick, the mentally insane, to put up hospitals, schools, all kinds of things. We don't even, our minds are not even focused in that area. That's showing you that our thinking has been perfectly guided to exactly what this man is saying. And I remember listening to a radio talk show. This was about 20 some odd years ago. And it's amazing. I talk about something 20 some odd years ago, and it's still relevant today. I remember I was listening to, what's this guy named? Bob Law. He used to run this program called Night Talk, AM radio, I think 16 something on the AM dial. And he was talking about that there was Harvard University was celebrating their 150th year of what they call shaping America. That's the word they use, shaping America. They understood clearly that the function and the goal of an educational system is to shape how one thinks. You, no matter what you were when you came in, when you leave, you would be a quote-unquote Harvard graduate. You would have a Harvard mentality, world mentality. You forget about what you were when you went in. Our job is to shape your mind to do what we want you to do. That's what I'm hearing up here. 25 years later, I'm hearing the same stuff. That went over a lot of people's head. I know they didn't get it. Go ahead, Aithan.
I'm going to say that blacks spend $1.1 trillion a year. They were saying within 3 to 5 years, it'd be 1.5 for blacks. Hispanics spend $1.2 trillion, because there's more of you, of course. $1.2 trillion a year, and 3 years, it'll be $1.7 trillion. So they're already doing estimates. They already know you're going to spend more, because they already know that your minds have been trained, if they want you to spend more money. So they already have estimates already. So together, combined, we spend $2.3 trillion together in this economy. $2.3 trillion, like Yasop was saying, now no part of it is reciprocated at all amongst ourselves, at all.
Let's go to the book of Luke, chapter 16. Luke 16. We've read this many times before. Now we're going to put it in perspective on this subject matter.
The book of Luke, chapter 16, verse 19.
Now I want y'all to pay close attention to this.
There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day.
So now this rich man is an Israelite man doing the bidding of Rome. Now you got to bring all what we're reading, you got to bring it up to today. You have many black and Latin leaders who's doing the bidding of America. They become rich and well off in society. Why? Because they're following America's protocol. Just like this man followed Rome's protocol. Read.
And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate.
Now this beggar, Lazarus, represents the mass of Israel. Right, what that Edomite said, the wage slave earners. Right. The masses of Israel, who are the poor, the down and out. That's who Lazarus represents of the Israelites. Go ahead.
And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table.
Now, he wanted to be fed with the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. Everything, remember, everything the rich man had on his table was given from Rome. So likewise, the rich man today, our black leaders, Latin leaders, the crumbs that we are getting, one crumb is named, well, let's see who's thinking. I need some thinking brothers up in here. You with the scarf on your neck. What's your name, brother? Ezra. Give me some crumbs. Can crumbs really sustain anybody? So it's not really talking about literal crumbs. It's talking about other things socially. You're on.
I would say food stamps, welfare, some of the public schools.
Some?
All.
See? All the public schools that we're under. So welfare, all the things that fall under the social, help me out with some words.
Service.
Social structure.
Yes. Social services, the infrastructure. Those are the crumbs that we're getting. And it's not meant to really sustain you with any real living. Like we think, like what we got out here is crumbs. We think this is living. This is not living.
We've been conditioned into believing that this is living.
Yeah, you got a TV, you might have a car, maybe a house. You think that's living. When you sit down, you talk to some white people, they go, yeah, where's your summer house at? Summer house.
You lost.
About summer house.
You were like, wow, what? I wonder what it's like to have a summer house.
A summer house. What do you mean a summer house? Yeah, when it gets winter, we all flat out our summer house when it's cold. Okay, what's that? What about your you know, when it's summertime, you ride with your car top down, the convertible. No, I ain't got that. Really, one car. Well, one car, you got two maybe? Oh, well, we got several. Seven even. What about your helicopter? You take a helicopter to school? What? Take a helicopter? What? You got a yacht. Where you go? You got people that come teach your children at home, tutors at home. What? And we like, we can't hang with them. Some of y'all deceive yourself into thinking you can, but you can't.
I'm going to go a step further, Elder. Listen to this. How many of us can say that we can go into our own land, go among our own financial institutions, our own government, our own military? Y'all follow what I'm saying? Spending our own currency, looking at the faces on the money and your faces on the money. Could you imagine how that would feel? We can't even fathom that kind of thinking.
We can't.
And that's a reality for some people. Some people have no idea what it's like to live like us. They can't even imagine this. If they even got close to it, they would commit suicide. Like when they had the depression in the 20 or 29, they just lost some money. And they were jumping out of windows.
Hey, what did the Quaker Oats man, George Bush Sr.'s wife, say? Remember when she went to...
The thing on, what was the name of that, when the levees broke. Exactly. To show you how out of touch these people are with the reality that we live in. Here are the people in New Orleans when they had that flood. Mm-hmm. They were being... Where they had to go live in the Astrodome, right?
Right.
They had to go... They left their homes, so-called homes, left their houses, and had to live in the Astrodome. The president's mama... They flying over it, and they looking at the little Negroes down there. They say, you know what? They're so much better off.
No, she was there.
She was there.
They took a tour through there.
She said, they are so much better off. Look at it. I can't even imagine she said that. That shows you the total disconnect and contempt. Thank you, brother. I couldn't even get the words out. The total disrespect and contempt that she has for black people.
Exactly.
That's amazing.
Now,
their reality is not our reality.
It's not. Back to Luke. What, Ithan, you got your thought together now?
Yes. Yeah. All right. You had the politicians, like Elder was saying earlier, and the celebrities. Them also. I don't know, rappers. Mm-hmm. They have the same thing. They had the crumbs also, but they call them crumbs. Video models, diamonds and gold, platinum. That's crumbs too.
Right.
And they're used as instruments to make us envy them. And they envy the white man.
Exactly.
They're in belt the white man. So those are the rich men also. They fall in that same category. And we get the crumbs. We buy their albums. We buy their albums. We go to their shows, their tours. They make millions of dollars on tours. And all the people in there saying, hey, Hova, they making minimum wage slaves.
Right.
Spend all their money trying to buy their sneakers, on buying their albums, buy their clothes, like that dude, their young brother. Was that Barney's?
Jay-Z did a business deal with Barney's. I'm not sure what that kind of store it is. But basically, he wanted to sell his merchandise there. A young black boy bought a belt from there. The belt was how much the belt? Like $300 for a belt. A sister spent $2,500 on a purse. That's the crumbs. She's a wage slave. I guarantee she's a wage slave. There you go right there. And they're blasting them, saying, you from the hood just like us, and you won't cut your ties with them. He's saying, I got to dig into the matter. I have to investigate more. What's to investigate? They called the cops on the boy for buying a belt. They fought him outside the store. They thought he stole it because the store called them. The cops don't blame us. Blame the store because the store called us. What you blaming us for? So I'm giving you an example of how that dude is heavily, he's like banging America right now. Those two are bedmates. Because he's like, I'm not getting my business with them.
Exactly.
And you got people from Brooklyn who go to Barney's saying, why don't you cut your ties with them? He will not do it. He will not do it. Because he's that rich man.
Right, he's that rich man. And America does that. They pull certain key blacks and Latinos up and allow them to make a lot of money. But they're still not on that. You know when you know you rich? When you can murder people and get away with it.
Yeah.
That's when you know you rich. The Lord can't touch you. Back to Luke 16 and 19. Pay close attention.
There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day.
So this rich man are the high society bourgeois Negroes amongst us. That's who the rich man represents. Go ahead.
And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus.
The beggar represents the masses of our people.
Which was laid at his gate full of sores.
Laid at his gate every day full of sores. Those are our sins. Go ahead.
And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table.
The crumbs represent the social services we get here in society. The education we get is a crumb. The wages we earn are crumbs. The foods we eat are crumbs. The housing we get is crumbs. Section 8 is crumbs. Everything we got here is crumbs.
Why is it that the Bible is using the word crumb? Because I heard the elder explained it earlier. I want to see if y'all really understand what's coming out. Why is it using the term crumb? And he explained it. I heard him explain it. So I'm going to see if y'all listening.
Because we can't survive off of it. It's like
exactly. You cannot survive off of a crumb. So in the case of the educational system, the educational system is a crumb compared to really being fed. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? So what, in other words, does the educational system prepare you to go build your nation up? No. That's the point.
Exactly. So again, like we said earlier, the Board of Ed is based upon white supremacy. Let's examine the curriculum. A lot of these kids are in school. They're in school. Let's talk about the curriculum in school a second. We're going to get back to the scriptures in a moment. I just need y'all to bear with me a second. In school, when we're young, we learn about Charles Darwin. Y'all familiar with that guy? He lived between 1809 and 1882. He wrote The Origin of Species, the evolutionary, that people come from monkeys. Okay, that's one thing we learn about, which teaches us to go against the Most High. Okay, then you learn about what's his name? Johann Friedrich Blumenbach. He's the Edomite that created the concept of five species of men. He said you got the Caucasian, Mongoloid, Negroid, Indian, and Malaysian. He divided the world into five groups of people. Then you got, in school they teach our kids about the founding fathers. You got George Washington, the first, nobody knows who he is? Yeah, first president, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, Benjamin Franklin. You don't have to write this down because I ain't gonna remember these people. Damn demons, Samuel Adams. Briefly in some class, you learn about Alexander Dumas, the writer who wrote The Three Musketeers. But he's black. But in school, they'll teach us that he's white. Three Musketeers, D'Artagnan, and everyone's fighting. Those are all black men when you read the book, blacks. But in school, that's how I'm telling you, the school system is based upon white supremacy. Like we said earlier about Huckleberry Finn, Tom Sawyer, written by Mark Twain. Then, last but not least, you learn about Cristobal Columbus, the most racist, murderous, genocidal maniac that ever lived. You don't believe it, because y'all think about Jenny, you think Hitler, no. Columbus was 12 times worse. Y'all don't understand. That dude murdered and enslaved millions from island to island. Him, Ponce de Leon, help me out here, Cortez. You know why? Because y'all hear the word, oh, Columbus and the conquistadors. And the Negroes think that conquistadors are some fashionista word. It's, what does it mean? Conquerors. These are demons. Oh, conquistadores. Yeah, oh, that sounds so fashionable. They are the devil, the Bible speaks of. It's all racist. And we let's honor. Why don't nobody do a holiday for Adolf Hitler? Or you'll see how society get quiet then. But they'll do a celebration for Christopher Columbus. And of all the Latinos and their dumb behinds, and some of you blacks too, on a float waving your flag, I got to learn Spanish. You stupid as hell. That's all racism, and our people don't think. That's why, like with Thanksgiving, I'm glad this one family stood up. How many of our people stand up for that? Here go the black woman. I'm just thankful for, I got a new pair of shoes, so I just want to thank God. Look, I got a table full of food. That's what I thank God about. You stupid black woman. It's a racist holiday about the murder, robbery, and destruction of our people. I don't know nothing about that.
All right. Inside Columbus's log. Are y'all listening? Inside Columbus's log, he has somewhere written where he speaks about gold. He said, gold is the most precious of all commodities. And he who possesses it possesses all that a man could ever want. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason why they honor Columbus Day. They tell you about whatever foolishness they tell you about on TV and all that, but the real deal is they believe in his philosophy. His philosophy is about taking all of the Earth's resources for yourself, and you deal with the other people according to how you want them in order for them to survive. Because just like we were talking about the end of poverty, the southern one, even the rain, all of that is the philosophy of Christopher Columbus. If you own all of the resources that people need, that means they'll have to go through high water and all kind of things just to get a little something. That's how these people think. That's the reason why their educational system reflects that. Right. Every nuance of educating medium in this society reflects that philosophy. Our people don't really understand what I'm talking about when I say that. Everything that this society is about reflects that mentality, reflects that philosophy.
Did I fail to mention that the founding fathers were all slave owners? I forgot to mention that thing. George Washington, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, Ben Franklin, Samuel Adams, they all owned our people as slaves. But we glorify them. These are the founding fathers. I just love them. You dumb as hell. Then, give me Isaiah 32. Give me Isaiah 32. Go ahead, Isaiah 32.
I don't know how much of you all watch. You got a show called Liberty Kids or something like that. They tried to show Benjamin Franklin and these four founding fathers as heroes, as they was trying to abolish slavery and they was kind to the slaves. You understand? One time I saw my daughter watching that crap. I'm like, yo, turn that station. Don't watch that. You understand? Because in these little cartoons that they put in up, that's also how they educate our kids and destroy our kids.
Right.
All right?
They go, the founding father said, behold, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Then you got Negroes jumping up. But meanwhile, there's amendments that says, no, a Negro is a property, 3/5 of a man. That didn't include you, dummy. But here you go. You got these coons out there. Watch this. Give me what I say, get?
Isaiah
32. Get me, what verse I want?
Five.
Yeah, there you go. Come on.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 32 and verse 5. The vile person shall be no more called liberal, nor the churl said to be bountiful.
So the vile person is called liberals. Who set up the school system? The liberals. Who introduced multicultural education? The liberals. The Bible says
the vile person. The vile person, what? Shall no more be called liberal. Go ahead.
For the vile person will speak villainy, and his heart will work iniquity.
Because what the liberals has done with the school system, it's all based upon white supremacy. That's what y'all have to understand. It is not for our benefit. We graduate with the little stupid cap and gown. What's the music? I don't even know the song.
Pomp and Circumstance.
How does it go? Dun, 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 dun. I don't know. Yeah. You know that dumb song? Oh, yeah, that's it. Do it, do it, do it. Dun, 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 dun. And the mothers are going, oh, my baby, look at my baby. Your baby has graduated to be a wage slave earner. Your baby is dumb as hell, mama. What you got, like that? Go ahead.
This is George Washington. Is
no,
this?
No, no. You got to repeat what you said because there was an audio glitch. I know they didn't hear what you just opened up with. They did not hear that.
George Washington?
That's right. Read that again.
This is President George Washington's statement about Negroes.
Where are you reading from? So let's put it up online.
It's a book. It's a state statement. It says presidents. I'll find it. It says shipped the slaves to the West Indies in exchange.
It says ship?
Shipped okay. The slaves to the West Indies in exchange for some rum and sundries. U.S. President George Washington in a letter addressed to Captain John Thompson on July 2nd, 1766, he sold a slave named Tom for liquor. He says, I advance as a suspicion only that the blacks are inferior to whites, both in body and mind. Never yet could I find that a black had uttered a thought above the level of a plain narration, ever saw an elementary tract of painting or sculpture. Thomas Jefferson, I have no purpose to introduce political and social equality between the white and black races. That I am not nor ever have been in favor of making voters or jurors of Negroes, nor of qualifying them to hold office, nor to intermarry with white people. And I will say in addition to this, that there is a physical difference between the two which, in my judgment, will probably forever forbid their living together upon the footing of a perfect equality. And then as much as it becomes a necessity that there must be a difference, I am in favor of the race to which I belong having a superior position. Abraham Lincoln, Negro's favorite. Not as the Negroes, I entirely agree with you that as a race and in a mass, they are altogether inferior to the whites. Theodore Roosevelt, it was the administration of Woodrow Wilson, however, which took the most drastic action against Negroes. It was in Wilson's administration and with his express approval, approval that federal civil service workers were segregated by race in their employment with separate eating and toilet facilities. When a Negro leader protested his segregation, Wilson, that's it. That's all I got.
So let me ask this question. Is there a really a such thing as integration in the society?
No. That's what we're reading right here.
Exactly. Because a lot of people really think that we have been quote unquote integrated. And I'm saying this to everybody. Because a lot of people don't know the meaning of words, Elder. That's what the problem is. The word integration. When you think about integration, you're taking two entities and you're bringing those two entities into one. That's what integration means. In other words, if you're talking about integrating two different people together, that means both have things that are pertinent to them that they are bringing to the table together to form something new. You understand? If you got two, in other words, let's say Chinese and, because I don't want to use us. Let's say Chinese people and Arabs. Let's say you want to bring those two people together. Well, the Chinese people have things that are pertinent to them. They'll bring themselves onto the table of integration with the Arabs. The Arabs are going to come and they have things that are pertinent to them. And they bring their things to the table of integration. When you finish with that mixing pot, both elements, the result has both things that are pertinent to each in that new mixture of people. Now, how does that correlate with us today? What did we bring to the table that is still here? Nothing. We don't have any land. We don't have our own. We don't have nothing. We have essentially become white people with black bodies. That's what we have become. We have lost everything that pertains to us. We have been assimilated, so you can understand. We have totally forgotten about who we are, and we have completely taken the mindset of the people that we call ourselves integrating with.
Okay. Zakai, where are we at now?
We had Isaiah 32 and verse 6.
Come on.
For the vile person will speak villainy.
Villainy refers to evil. Go ahead.
And his heart will work iniquity.
His heart will work sin. Go ahead.
To practice hypocrisy.
Because the whole school system is hypocrisy. This whole society is hypocrisy. Like Deacon Yahusha was just talking about, what was integration? Y'all say, many of y'all think if people ask you, are we integrated, you'd go, yes, we're not integrated. I got sad news for you. Can somebody tell a woman that we're not really integrated with white society? Because she thinks we are.
Of course she thinks we are.
We're not integrated. I'm giving it, like Deacon Yahusha gave good examples. Now, at some level, when you, like in Kentucky, you got to go to Kentucky. The only ones who are integrated with blacks and Latinos are, I got to say it, poor white trash.
Yes.
And they're only socially integrated. Now, when you go to the schools and public schools, guess what? Those whites that are integrated with us, poor white trash. That's what they are. To be totally integrated, like Yahusha brought a good example, you got to bring something to the table. Here we go. Once the emancipation, no, let me go up ahead of that. Let me go further past. When integration, Martin Luther King and all that, wanted to be, the civil rights movement wanted to be integrated. Medgar Evers and all of them. To be integrated, not only are you integrated like you'd have black, white, so forth and so on. That goes when you go home. Where you live would be black, white. But guess what? To be totally integrated also with me, you are economically integrated, which we are not. Because all the monies that whites made through the rape, robbery, wait, hold Isaiah, get me Jeremiah. You know what I want? Is it 22? You know what I want? Zakai?
22:13.
Okay, Jeremiah 22:13. Get that for us.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 22.
I want everybody to get it so nobody think I made this up. I need y'all to read along with us. Jeremiah 22:13. Listen good. Now, this is for you. We're all integrated. Watch this. Go ahead.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 22 and verse 13. Woe unto him that buildeth his house by unrighteousness.
This whole house of America has been built by unrighteousness. Read.
And his chambers by wrong.
And his homes and houses by wrong. Go ahead.
That useth his neighbor's service without wages.
That uses his neighbor's service without wages. Come on.
And giveth him not for his work.
The Bible says that's iniquity. That's a sin. To be totally integrated, all that was made in this society has to be given back to us. The white man will never do that. You have banks say, oh, we apologize for having our hand in slavery. That's not true. They're not apologetic.
Right.
Because if I steal $5 from you and I say, I'm sorry, what should I do? Give it back. What has white society given back to us? Nothing but bad education and jail. So what kind of apology is it really? Now go back to Isaiah 32. This is why the Bible says this. Isaiah 32, what verse is it?
Verse 6. For the vile person will speak villainy, and his heart will work iniquity, to practice hypocrisy.
To practice hypocrisy. It's hypocritical to steal from a nation, apologize for it, then give them nothing in return. That's hypocrisy. That's evil. Go ahead.
And to utter error against the Lord.
And to utter error against the Lord, because the entire school system utters error against the Lord. Go ahead.
To make empty the soul of the hungry.
Because we go to school, we're hungry, but it's making us more empty. The little bit of God understanding we got is removed from us when we enter the school system. Go ahead.
And he will cause the drink of the thirsty to fail.
Right. Whatever drink we had coming to us, it fails. Come on.
The instruments also of the churl are evil.
The instruments of the word churl there means rude. Meaning what? They're rude, they're devilish. What are the instruments that they have that are evil? Their politics, their political democracy, republicanism, independent, conservative, that's all evil. Then you got the religious instruments, Baptist, Pentecostal, Mormon, Anglican, Seventh-day Adventist, Jehovah's Witness, that's all evil. Then you got the school system, public school. Those are instruments that are evil. Read that again, Zakai.
The instruments also of the churl are evil.
All their instruments are evil. Whether it's political, religious, economic, it's all evil. Because we always end up getting the short end of the stick. We never, as a mass of people, come out on top. Never, ever, ever. Come on.
He deviseth wicked devices.
So this is God speaking. The Bible's letting you know that the ruling kingdom in the last days would devise what?
Wicked devices.
Wicked devices. They are very crafty. Come on.
To destroy the poor.
To what?
To destroy the poor.
So what you thought was for our benefit, the Bible says it's to destroy. It's like many of you think welfare is for our benefit. Oh, you. Welfare was always for our destruction, to divide the home. The little families we managed to hold together have been divided because of welfare. You want welfare, you want the government to support you, black woman, Latin woman, get rid of that man. You cannot have a man in the house. Okay. Now we've gotten so accustomed to that, when a woman gets a man and he leaves, she's confused. Why? Because it's second nature now. Why I got to stick around for? You got welfare, I can't be around. So these, read it again, Zakai.
To destroy the poor with lying words.
Right, what did you say? You said legalizing weed. You got dumb blacks and Latinos talking about hip, hip, hooray. That's a trap. Because now amongst the jobs, they're going to say mandatory job testing for blacks and Latinos. And we're going to do, it ain't going to be the piss in a cup. Because you can fool that, cut his hair. Because that hair goes back 2 years. Our people are just simple as hell. The drugs that we have used holds in your hair for 2 years. Oh, the white man legalized marijuana. Yeah, you a big dummy. You don't see the trap in that? The little jobs we got now, them little wage earners you got, you ain't gonna have that in the future. It's gonna be war.
And just because you shave your head don't mean he can't get the hair. He'll go to your leg. He get the hair from anywhere because it's all the same.
On my job, they did that. Dude came in bald head. They said, well, you got eyebrow. He shaved all his pubic hair off. They said the only hair he had was eyebrows. They said, guess what? We taking them eyebrows. That's what you ain't getting away. They had one dude bend over and spread them. They said, there's hair somewhere, and we going to get it. This whole thing, legalizing weed, is a legal trap. A legal trap to get you out of school. Not that that's a bad thing anyway, but they're trying to get us down and out, destitute of all humanity. They're justified by kicking us out of schools and keeping us off certain jobs, all the jobs, including McDonald's. You watch. Don't say you never heard it. Don't say you was confused and didn't know as you puffing on a blunt, you dummy. Zakai, where you at?
Verse 7.
Come on.
To destroy the poor with lying words.
See that? To destroy the poor with lying words. All these words, that's why they use big words. Black people don't know what they're talking about. I think he said something for our benefit. Yeah, he did. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's why they use them words.
What does the scriptures mean when it says to destroy the poor? Because some people actually think it's talking about being put to death. Because our people don't understand that we are destroyed.
Right.
You know, when I sit here and I think about how they pay these athletes millions of dollars to run up and down the court, up and down the gridiron, throwing the pointed ball over the tee and all that. Football. When I think about how they pay him all kinds of money to do that mess, they'll give him money because he doesn't know what to do with the money. When I compare that to our people spending $1 trillion, they don't have a problem with that. As a matter of fact, they encourage us to do more, spend more. Give the Negroes more money so that we can get it back. That's the same thing they do with these ball players, the same thing. Why? Because we don't have enough sense to take that money and use it to build up right where we are. We don't know how to do that. So we are already destroyed. You are destroyed when you have no land. When you pass no laws, when you govern nothing, you are a destroyed people. Do you realize that those are the essentials that make a people? You have to have your own land.
But you know what? Some black people and Latin people think they're okay because they say, well, I got a job that makes $100,000. That's $100,000 job is different than $100,000 of wealth. Two different things, because the $100,000 in wealth is invested in other things that's always going to be turning over. Right. But the black and Latin man that makes $100,000, you're living check to check. There's a big difference between wealth and a job. Two different things. Who's Laba? You gonna say yeah. Somebody?
Yeah, I'm gonna pick up exactly what the elder said. Even though the one who make $100,000+, there was a special done. They still have the same bank account of poor people who have, mm-hmm. because they spend crazy. And then there was also a special. Sometime when the Bible said these people are evil. There's a white woman who do a special. You remember, I don't know if you're paying attention. She put blue eyes people, black eyes people.
What was this woman's name? Oh, man, I forget the name. That was a heavy, heavy point that you're making out.
Yeah.
I can't think of that woman's name.
Then the white woman come with the whole conclusion, say white people was born evil. That's what the white woman said. It's saying that was born racist. It says in their gene. You understand? Their own people notice that. You understand? These men, the so-called white people, when you examine them, they can do nothing good. I'm telling you. That device they create among us, then you will think this to help us. But it's always a trap. It's to our people. It's to our people, not the other nation. Open your doors, looking at the college. Who you see in them? White people. So when the white society pushed the billion they sent out here, you understand? They're not sending it to you. So they're justifying saying, you see, we give you a job. But even though they give you a job, how you spend the money foolishly, so you can never say that they didn't look out for you. Because they don't put nothing in our community to help us to substance the money they're giving us. You understand? So they justify when they say, we give you a job. Look at a $100,000 job. You have this black have a job. You have this. But you fail to understand all white, young white girl, young black, young white men, they already stand by for the money. They're already in a standby for the money.
The elder was saying, you have people
Jane Elliott, that's her name. Yep. Jane Elliott.
People who are rich. Basketball players are rich. The white man that owned a team is wealthy.
Right.
Wealth is passed on from child to child. Mm-hmm. Our forefathers, they passed their wealth on from child to child.
You're talking about the Bible forefathers.
The Bible, our forefathers, right. Not the devil, of course. our forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob passed their wealth on to their family.
Right.
You understand? King David passed his wealth on to Solomon. All right? So what I'm saying is that the white man, they're wealthy. Black folks who are rich, that can go any day. Mm-hmm. White folks get wealth, that money is passed on from child to child. They own roads.
Right. And you know where that wealth, who can remember where the white people's wealth come from? Slavery. That's why they got a term called old money. Meaning from slavery times. Back in the days of rape, robbery, and murder. That's where that old money comes from. Yes, Abiel.
This is an article that someone had posted on Facebook. This is a gentleman by the name of Damon Dash. He said he overheard a Jewish businessman, call black people liquid money. And it says right here, Damon Dash says a Jewish man calls black people liquid money because we give it all away. Mm. In a recent article, Dash quoted a colleague saying, "We call you black people liquid money. The same way that water falls out of a man's hands, money typically seeps out of a black person's hands the same way. Mm. Your community gets money and immediately it gives it all away to the people who aren't black. Yep. We see that as a huge business opportunity. Examples used: black people on payday or when they get our tax refunds. He noted blacks to an Indian business, Indian meaning East Indian, business to cash the check. An Asian hair salon, a corner store owned by Arabs, or a department store owned by whites. When it's all said and done, these other business people are waiting like hungry animals to eat blacks' bank accounts as if they are the prey.
That's the reason why they could get the bank loans. Because they tell the banker inside, they say, well, how do you expect to paid us the bank back. They said, well, I'm going to open up business in a nigga neighborhood.
Right.
They said, I'm going to get the money back and then some. Oh, well, here's $1 billion. Go open it up.
You know,
they know he's going to get his money back. Go ahead, Elder.
Let's go. I forgot to read on in Luke 16. We just read an article that about Damon Dash, about how these other nations come in and wait for us to have our payday because we're going to spend our money on them. Look what Christ said here in Luke 16. Zakai, read that again.
The book of Luke, chapter 16, verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day.
So this rich man, as we know, represents blacks and Latinos, the Israelites that work for Rome, who are well paid and they're in that rich level. Go ahead.
And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus.
The beggar represents the Israelites that were repentant in Christ. That's who Lazarus represents, the repentant Israelite, amongst which is our people. Go ahead.
Which was laid at his gate, full of sores.
Full of sores, meaning our sins.
And desiring to be
and
fed.
And social problems that we go through. Go ahead and do what?
And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table.
So the crumbs are these various social services, whether it's political, religious, economic, school, educational. These, we get the crumbs of society, the lowest part, the worst. Go ahead.
Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores.
Moreover, the dogs came. Abriel, I want you to go right back to that article. Go right back. We're going to read about the dogs came. Damon Dash. Damon Dash. Now, the bottom part, where is that? Example used. We're going to read about the dogs came. It says, example used. Black people on payday or when they get our tax refunds, he noted blacks to an Indian, East Indian business to cash the check. So an East Indian man cashes your check, meaning you got to pay him to cash your check. There's a fee for that. An Asian hair salon, because the black and Latin woman runs to the Chinese woman to get their hair done. A corner store owned by Arabs and or a department store owned by whites. When it's all said and done, these other business people are waiting like hungry animals. Dogs. Dogs. Go back to Luke now. Read that again, Zakai.
Luke 16, 21. And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores.
Moreover, the dogs came and whatever we had, the dogs sucked it out of us. They licked it from us. So whatever little bit we get in society, here come the other nations. That's what it's talking about. I'm going to show you that the dogs is talking about the nations. Give me that in Exodus. Exodus 11 and 7. Because some of y'all right now talking, no, you got that Christian mindset. Think the dogs is talking about dogs. Right. It's talking about nations of people.
Right. The book of Exodus, chapter 11 and verse 7. But against any of the children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue. Against man or beast, that ye may know how that the Lord doth put a difference between the Egyptians and Israel.
So in that verse, who do the dogs represent in that verse? Egyptians. The Egyptians. Nations. That's what it's talking about. It's calling them dogs. Right. Let's get that. Matthew 15. And 27, thank you.
The book of Matthew, chapter 15, and verse 27. And she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs...
Start at 26.
Verse 26. But he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs.
So Christ said, it's not good. The children's bread is this. The Bible, Christ's healing power. This is the children's bread because this was only given to the Israelites. He said, it's not good to take the children's bread and cast it to who? Read on.
And she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table.
So this white woman, because it's a white woman, she said, can I get a little crumb, please? And when you read on, she was begging him. And he said, all right, for this saying, the devil's cast out of your daughter.
For the saying that she's a dog.
Right.
And you know what it's also show? When we got our kingdom set up, that the heathens, they going to eat of the crumbs. The same way are we eating these crumbs in this society, mm-hmm. in the same way the heathens, they're going to eat off our crumbs.
That's right.
You understand when the kingdom is set up.
Exactly.
Yeah, our people don't believe that thing. That's why I said our people have not been taught the Bible at all. They hear stuff coming out of this Bible, and they cannot believe that this is the Bible.
Right. Exactly. Go back to Isaiah 32, Zakai. What verse you was at?
Verse 7.
Now, last week in Chicago, a sister got so mad at the class, they said, she walked out. That made me rejoice. I said, dang. She said, I can't take it. They always bashing a woman. And I'm thinking about the class. I said, we went over like 16 personality types. I don't think all them personalities was talking about women on all of them. Some of them we did. Some of them was men. So I said, here's something else. But guess what? If the sister's online, we coming for you right now. Come on. All right.
Verse 7 again. Isaiah chapter 32, verse 7. The instruments also of the churl are evil.
The instruments. When y'all breaking this down on the street, you got to break down their instruments. The things that are used in social society today. Politics is an instrument. Educational system is an instrument. Religion is an instrument. Economics is an instrument. Okay, read.
Wait, hold on, I'm sorry. In order to properly break that down, you have to think about, like the elders bringing out these instruments that are used to destroy our people. You have to first know what your people need.
Right.
Our people need a kingdom. Our people need a homeland. Our people need their own government. Our people need their own structure, their own monetary system, their own military. They need those. Our people need those. Those things are essential for any nation. So when you think about what our people do not have, then you can examine those instruments. Because all of those instruments that we're going over, none of those instruments help you get any of those things that I just mentioned. Can I get a witness? Are any of these instruments vital in us getting our land? No. Is it about getting our own military? No. Our own infrastructure? No. Our own currency? No. Will it allow us to pass laws among ourselves to govern civility among us? No.
Exactly. Read on, Zakai. What verse you at?
Still in verse 7. He devises wicked devices to destroy the poor with lying words.
Right, like Planned Parenthood. They said that that's good for our good. No, that's to destroy us. That's to destroy us, to shut down our numbers, cut down our numbers. They said we're too numerous. Go ahead.
Even when the needy speaketh right.
Even when we speak right things, they will come with some crafty stuff against us. Read.
But the liberal deviseth liberal things, and by liberal things shall he stand.
This society is quote-unquote a liberal society. That's what they stand on. They have us as wage slaves, wage slave owners, makers. They have us with the least education. That's how that society keeps going. Watch this.
Rise up, ye women that are at ease.
Now, why is he talking to the woman? He says, rise up, you women that are at ease. Because women are at ease in the American society. Right. I don't see nothing wrong with what's going on. And you brothers that listen to women, you dumb as hell. The same way Adam listened to Eve, God said, I'm going to jack you up for listening to her. Tell you, I made you. You listening to her. She don't know nothing. You got the, what's wrong with society? Can't we all? No, we all can't get along. Not while we're on the bottom, no. Read that again.
Rise up, ye women that are at ease. Hear my voice, ye careless daughters.
Now he calls them careless. Women are careless, God says. Oh, woman, the sister last week said, I can't take the Bible, it's male chauvinistic. Well, good rant and drop dead. Where you get that term for male chauvinist? She got that from the where? The feminist movement. That's another instrument. Here in the 60s, you had the many black revolutionary, Latino revolutionary group rise up. The white man said, listen, white woman. Not that he's the white woman I'm using as now. Listen, white woman, you're going to take your funky behind up in there. Stir stuff up. So the white woman said, I'm going to go in there with some new stuff, some feminist stuff. She went up in there, said to the black woman, look, black woman, you don't need to listen to this black man over here. Look, Latin woman, you don't need to listen to this black man. Women are strong. Women, we can do it ourselves. And the woman separates from her husband and goes, Women power, yeah, well, and destroyed everything.
The black woman separated from her husband, but the white woman did not separate from her husband.
Thank you. Thank you.
Because when the white man told her what to do, she said, yes, I'll do that.
Right. I'm going to give y'all an
example. Because she's in league with him.
Right. Look at Beyonce's latest, that thing she put up on iTunes, I think it is. Huh? They got a physical copy now? Well, I forgot the name of the album. I forgot what it is. But when they interviewed her, she said, the backbone to this album was that women can do what they want. Women are powerful. It was that whole feminist bullcrap. I'm listening. I said, this sounds like stuff from, and Beyonce, when you listen to her, she's not the smartest sister in the world. You could tell by the words she used, the way she says them. I'm like, where is she getting this from? About women rule and we are so powerful. I said, this is bullcrap. She wouldn't have got where she's at if it wasn't for who? Think? Who gave up their job and used all that money for her? Nobody knows. Her daddy. Her black big lip daddy. The man gave up his career for her. And here she go, women, we are so powerful. Like, shut up. Yeah, she did. When she got to the point of power, alleged, she got rid of her daddy. Thank you. She said, nigga, I don't need you no more. Right. When that's that whole feminist thing, there's a white woman in her ear somewhere. And I pray, I really, now, and don't think we're saying this stuff out of hatred, because we love Beyonce, her father, all our people. Our prayer is that they all repent and we can come together, that one third of Israel. Zakai, where you at?
Verse 9.
Come on.
Rise up, ye women that are at ease. Hear my voice, ye careless daughters. Give ear unto my speech. Many days and years shall ye be troubled, ye careless women. For the vintage shall fail, the gathering shall not come.
So God is getting on the woman. Now, that's why I said there's many scriptures he gets directly on the woman. You sisters might not want to hear it. We don't give a damn. We're going to tell you what God says. The only women that's going to be saved out of this destruction are those that humble down and say, yes, Lord, this is me. Yes. Them others, arms crossed and folded, I don't want to hear that. They're going to die. Some of your wives going to die. Some of your daughters going to die. Don't be shocked. Because they're going to read stuff like this and go, I don't like that. Why? Because she's been watching CNN. Or one of these on these news, what is it?
Yeah,
scandal, all that crap.
Headquarters has been set up in her head.
Right. So the Bible calls them careless and women that are at ease. Because they're at ease on welfare in society. Not realizing that has destroyed her family. We're going to talk about raising kids in a moment. Now, multicultural, the liberals set up multiculturalism. I'm going to show you multiculturalism. Let's read it. Go back, Abiel. This one right here. Blow it up big. Put the article. I want the article up there. This is mathematics, because some of y'all in here got a brother that's a math teacher. That's good. All praise to the Most High. We need to know how to count. So the liberals said black people need to learn how to count. Latin people need to learn how to count. We're going to help them count. Watch what they did. It says, this is New York now. New York School assigns racist word problems to fourth graders. Go down. Look at the picture. Go down. Look at the picture. Today, in advice we didn't think, we didn't think would ever require repeating. Teachers, it is never a good idea to use dead slaves as units of measurement in your math problems. On Thursday, New York One revealed the story of a New York public school that has been doling out some incredibly unorthodox homework. When a fourth grade teacher asked student teacher Aziza Harding to make copies of the worksheets, Harding was stunned to see it was a slavery word problems homework assignment. The word problems included the question, in a slave ship, there could only be 3,799 slaves. One day the slaves took over the ship. 1,897 are dead. How many slaves are alive? And one slave got whipped 5 times a day. How many times did he get whipped in a month? 31 days. Another slave got whipped 9 times a day. How many times did he get whipped in a month? How many times did the two slaves get whipped together in 1 month? See, this is some madness here. I ain't want to read no more. This is just madness. Go ahead. This is straight up madness.
it's madness on one level, but on another level.
Wait, y'all, what's up? Before you say it, remember at the beginning of the class, they had the first article I showed y'all about white supremacy? Now, y'all might have thought it was only out there in the West, out in the South. That's here in New York, too. These white teachers have their meetings, and they go out in the South and meet and bring this. This is the evidence that these people come back with that madness. Go ahead, y'all.
Who brought this article out? I don't mean us in here. I mean, who's the editor behind this? Who brought this to light? Who went and exposed it? That's my question.
Mary Elizabeth Williams. But it said New York One reported it.
Okay, New York One reported it.
Right.
Let me think about what I want to say about this. They brought that out because they knew that that was going to cause an adverse reaction. Our people were going to light up and go crazy over that particular article. Are not they trying to take slavery out of the schools?
Mm-hmm.
Ithon, can I get a witness?
Folks, now it's time for my perspective. It is stunning to the degree some people will go to totally rewrite history because they really don't like how it turned out. So what is happening in Tennessee right now? You have some Tea Party groups in Tennessee, and you know what they want to do? They actually want to literally remove slavery from textbooks. Some of them are saying, well, let's augment it. Let's actually show that some African Americans owned slaves. It wasn't just whites actually owned slaves. And so they want to really change or rewrite history. What's also crazy in this whole piece is they say, well, they also are critical of people who criticize the founding fathers for having slaves. These are honorable men. It's a fact. Many of them own slaves. So therefore, how do you want to now change a fact? We can't be quiet when these things happen. We saw what happened in Texas when conservatives began to change the laws in the books. If liberals try it, we go after them as well. Bottom line is, don't be silent and wait for it to be passed and then you get upset. Challenge every change now and hold people accountable. That's my perspective. What is yours?
They're trying to take slavery out of the schools.
Or change it.
By them using this right here stops that. This right here goes against them trying to take it out. Now I'm not justifying what they did, but I'm making a point that by them mentioning slaves and slave ships and all of that, that's keeping that thing going. You follow me? So it's a double-edged sword on this thing. On one instant, they want to get rid of it, and on another instant, they want to keep it.
But I'm going to tell you why they use it, y'all. So. Why do they use it? Why did she see fit to use it? This is in case any black child gets any spirit to become more than they are meant to be. That reading will humble them down. And the kids will go, you was a slave. Or imagine how that black child feels in school with the other kids of other nations. You was whipped five times. My daddy whipped your daddy five times a day. You know how little kids do. They ain't right. They're wrong.
That is correct. That is correct. That is 100% correct, which goes to something else that I want to bring up, but go ahead.
Jonah, you had your hand up?
Got a quick question. I'm trying to connect the dots here, and they're trying to get us to remove slavery out of schools by doing that.
No, they want to romanticize slavery. Right. I saw the article. Right. They want to make it seem like we were indentured servants and the slaves got wages and they didn't get whipped or any of that. That's what they're trying to do. Now, what were you going
to
say?
Right. To go to the point that the elder's making about how it creates an inferiority complex with us. Because that's the backlash that you're going to get from reading that kind of material. That's the point about what was being used in the classroom. They say, how dare you bring out these kinds of things and use this as a learning tool when you're just embarrassing and shaming us and reminding us of what happened to us in slavery. I understand that part of it. I do understand that part of it. I'll save our part for later because I don't want to bring it in just right now. Continue, Elder.
No. So now you'll get people that'll say, what's wrong with a multicultural, what's the word? Curriculum, thank you. A multicultural curriculum. There's something wrong with it. When you have a curriculum dictated by white supremacists, where do blacks end up in a multicultural curriculum? On the bottom. So there is something wrong with it. Go to Daniel 2 and 36. Daniel 2. Multicultural. And it sounds like it's all inclusive. Oh, no. Because 95% of, because that's what we get. They call it multiculturalism. 95% of what we're learning is white supremacy. The other 3, 4, and 5% you learn about Chinese, East Indian, maybe, blacks and Latinos. That's the last 5%. That's not all inclusive. And nobody's, there's no, none of these black and Latin teachers, we're going to talk about y'all. Not you, Solomon. You on the side. But we're going to get on you black teachers and you Latin teachers. We're going to get on y'all. Where we at?
Daniel 2:36.
Yeah. Now, let me set it up for y'all. This is the dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had about the last days. He could not understand what the dream meant. Abio, pull up a picture of the dream, the statue. Okay, this is Nebuchadnezzar's dream. This is what we're about to read in Daniel 2. We're getting to the interpretation of the dream. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 36. Let's start there.
All right. The book of Daniel chapter 2 and verse 36. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of heaven hath he given into thine hand, and hath made thee ruler over them all. Thou art this head of gold.
So now look at the painting. The head of gold, remember, was made into four different categories. You had the head was made of gold. The arms were made of, what was it? Silver. Then you had the midsection of bronze. The legs of iron. And the feet were made of iron and clay. So now go back to the top, Abiel. So the head of gold represented the Babylonian Empire. Everybody understand that, right? Now you might ask yourself, what does this have to do with today's class? As we read down, you shall see how this plays in vitally. Read on.
And after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee. And another
third. The next kingdom was the Medo-Persian Empire, represented the silver. Everybody see that? Write that down. The silver in 538 BC represented the Persians and the Mede Empire, Medo-Persian Empire. Okay, everybody got that? Read on.
And another third kingdom of brass.
And now the third kingdom of brass represented Alexander and the Greeks of 333 BC. That was the brass. Everybody there? Read on.
Which shall bear rule over all the earth.
So the white man, which came as the Greeks, because they conquered Japhet, they conquered the whole earth. You can read about that in 1 Maccabees chapter 1. Read on.
And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron.
Now the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. That was Rome in 63 BC. Go ahead.
For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these shall it break in pieces and bruise.
So Rome destroyed everybody right behind the Greeks, because Rome didn't conquer the Greeks. Rome absorbed the Greek. That's why many books call it the Greco-Roman Empire, because they were the same people. Go ahead.
And whereas thou sawest the feet and
now
toes.
Now he gets to the feet. The feet represents these last days under America, because America is an extension of ancient Rome, of the Greco-Roman Empire. Listen good to what I'm saying. America represents the feet. Read it again.
And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes.
Notice it says feet and toes. How many toes are there?
Ten.
When you read Revelation 13, it talks about the 10 horns. That's the 10 common markers, also called the EU. Write this down. The European Union represents the toes in Daniel 2. Represents the 10 horns in Revelation 13, Revelation 17, Revelation 12. Okay? The 10 horns in Revelation are the same 10 toes of Daniel 2. Everybody with me? Read again.
And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron.
So part of potter's clay. Listen good. This last kingdom is part of potter's clay and part of iron. Go ahead.
The kingdom shall be divided.
The kingdom shall be divided. Come on.
But there shall be in it of the strength of the iron.
There shall be in it the strength of the iron, because remember, Rome had a powerful army. Guess what? America has a powerful military also. But watch this. Keep going.
For as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay, and as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken.
So it's partly strong and partly weak, this kingdom. He's going to explain what he means by that. Go ahead.
And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men.
So he's explaining what the iron and the clay represents, mixing themselves with the seed of men. That's this integration everybody keep talking about. Oh, we all can get together and mingle. That's why they call America the great melting pot. Read it again, Zakai.
And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another.
But what? Read that again.
But they shall not cleave one to another.
That's why there's always problems socially. Black against white, white against black, them against the Latinos. There's always something. The Bible has prophesied in these last days, this last kingdom shall be partly strong and partly weak. It shall be made of iron and clay. And he explains what that clay is. When you got other nations trying to appease, like Obama's in office, everybody's, oh, there's a man of color, he's black. Him trying to appease, it's impossible to appease all nations here. Somebody's going to get the short end of the stick. And guess who it always is? Our people. We always get asked out. Excuse my language. Read that again, Zakai.
But they shall not cleave one to another.
The Bible prophesies these, all these nations shall not cleave one to another. It don't matter if you marry them. Well, who remembers during, what was that last hurricane in not Katrina. Sandy, remember the black woman married the white man and had two boys. She ran for help to the white people. Help me, my boys is trapped in the car. What do white people do? Slam the door. Boom. And cut the lights off, make like they ain't home. Her two boys died, drowned in a river. And she's all confused. I married a white man. Why didn't white people help me? Because the Bible has prophesied, Zakai, one more again.
But they shall not cleave one to another.
That's the prophecy. If you're trying to fight that prophecy, you're fighting God.
Right.
You're on the wrong end of the stick, and your arms are too short to fight with God, to box with God. He said the nation shall not cleave one to another. Here you go. You want to fight against that. So when we bring it out, you want to say, oh, we're racist. Believe me, we're far from it. But we are going to tell you the truth. We are going to tell you what thus saith the Lord, whether you like it or not.
Right.
Was that it, Zakai?
No.
Go ahead.
Even as iron is not mixed with clay.
Even as iron is not mixed with clay, the nation shall not mix one with another. That's why when you move into a home, they have something called, what is it called? Social steering. Y'all know what that's talking about? Where you're a black man, you want to live in a certain community, they steer you to where black people live. Or if you're Puerto Rican, they try to steer you to where Latinos live. Or that's why, like in Flushing, there's a large community of East Indians. How do y'all live over there? Because there's something called social steering. They steer you to where they want you to go and tell you this area might not be too good for you. Why? Because they know certain things about the people in those areas. You might want to live over here. But I don't want to live over there. I want to live over here while we're telling you what you need.
A lot of people didn't realize that.
Right. Now, Abiel, pull up for me. Randy Weingarten. Now, I said earlier that the American school system, United States school system, is based upon white supremacy. Some of y'all thought that was odd. Many of y'all see her on the news quite often. Y'all know who she is? She is the president of the teachers union. Now you may say to yourself, like what we just read about the slaves and the math problems and all that, these are the people that deals with all this stuff. She is president of the teachers union. You think she's gonna change the way the curriculum? You think she don't know that Christopher Columbus was a genocidal maniac? She know that. You think she's going to fight to change it? She ain't going to fight to change nothing. Let's go to the next one. Get me John King Jr. Right there. That's him. That is him. Now, he's a black man. Oh, he might be Latino. I'm not too sure. He had that complexion. Now, he is the New York State Education Commissioner. Because you know why I bring this up? Because a lot of us go, if only we had a black or Latino in power, things will be better for us. You fool yourself. These are puppets for the American system. This man has been in his seat as the New York State Commissioner of Education for a long time. He has made no changes in the racist school curriculum at all. And he will not make any changes. He can't. He lacks the testicular fortitude to do anything. He is a puppet on a string. Now, let's go to the school chancellors. Get me Joe Klein. Now, Joe Klein was the school chancellor for New York City from 2002 to 2011. The curriculum has remained the same. Because some of you think, oh, Jewish people are for us. They love us. He's Jew, so-called Jew, Amalek. And so was Randy Weingarten. Those are so-called Jews who went to private schools and went to schools of learning and education that far, supersedes us, surpasses us. Now, get me Kathy Black. Kathy Black. Now, she was only the school, she was the school chancellor right after Joel Klein. She only lasted a few months, she quit. She was New York City school chancellor for like 8 months, something like that. She did no change.
Speaking of black, the reason I just whispered to the elder, I said, that's my woman. Now, why did I say that? What was one of the reasons why her chancellorship got cut so short?
She said, can we get some child, I'm sorry. What's the word I'm looking for?
Can we have some birth control, please?
Can we have
please?
Some birth control, please?
That's the woman that said that.
In the news.
In the news.
Right.
That's the reason why I mentioned her.
So now, Dennis Walcott, New York City school chancellor from 2011 to 2013. There's a new one coming in. He's still in until I don't know if they assigned a new one yet, did they?
Yeah, they did.
Okay. We see black faces and go, yay, hip hop, yeah, black man. These black men are the weakest men you will ever find. Make no changes and will push the lies of, and they'll examine the school curriculum and they know it's racist. They will say nothing for that almighty paycheck. Nothing. They're puppets. Perfect puppets. So we deceive ourselves into believing black people in power will change things. They ain't going to change a daggone thing. Now, black people in authority have no power. Now, I'm going to show you that on a political level. Get me in a movie, Fahrenheit 9/11 by Michael Moore. Because you go, oh, we need black politicians. I'm going to show you a black politician got no power. Y'all keep deceiving yourselves here in America, in society. The only changes that will be made is when we, Nation of Israel, the one-third of Israel, makes the change. That is it. Now I'm going to set it up. Al Gore has just run for president. And black people, our black people are just simple as hell. What is wrong with our people? Al Gore was the vice president to, what's his name? Clinton. Everybody liked Bill Clinton. Why? Because he could play the saxophone, smoke weed, open up office in Harlem, and secretly, I ain't going to say what, I know what he was doing. Y'all know what he was doing, too. Here come the black women. Oh, Clinton, can I come up to your office? You can come up to my office.
What'd he say? I dropped something on the floor under my desk.
So now, yeah, pick that up. Al Gore has just run for president. It looks like he's about to win. But all of a sudden, Bush's, what's his cousin?
Who was Jeb Bush.
Jeb Bush was the governor of Florida. Florida had a problem. They said no. The winner goes to Bush. So now.
Bush was so bold, he said on a plane before the thing happened, he said, we're going to win Florida.
Right. What I want y'all to listen to is listen to the black people that address Al Gore, who has just lost the election. Listen to how much
These black politicians will kiss defeat. I'll say that word. Of this, watch, just listen. And listen, watch their power, watch.
Good. Like the elder was bringing out, Al Gore was the presidential candidate.
Right.
He lost, but he also was the head of the House. House of Representatives. Right. So he had a dual role. So he had to go back. After he had lost, he still had to carry his functions as Speaker of the House over the House of Representatives. Mm-hmm. So there are certain rules that pertain to that House that he still had to uphold. So I need y'all to listen carefully. Listen to the words that's being said in this thing.
On the day the joint session of both the House of Representatives and the Senate was to certify the election results, Al Gore, in his dual role as outgoing Vice President and President of the Senate, presided over the event that would officially anoint George W. Bush as the new president. If any congressman wanted to raise an objection, the rules insisted that he or she had to have the signed support of just one senator.
Mr. President, and I take great pride in calling you that, I must object because of the overwhelming evidence of official misconduct, deliberate fraud, and an attempt to suppress voter turnout.
The chair must remind members that under Section 18 of Title 3, United States Code, no debate is allowed in the joint session.
Thank you, Mr. President. To answer your question, Mr. President, the objection is in writing, signed by a number of members of the House of Representatives, but not by a member of the Senate.
Mr. President, it is in writing and signed by several House colleagues on behalf and myself of the 27,000 voters of Duval County, in which 16,000 of them are African Americans that was disenfranchised in this last election.
Is the objection signed by a member of the Senate?
Not signed by a member of the Senate. The Senate is missing.
Mr. President, it is in writing and signed by myself on behalf of many of the diverse constituents in our country, especially those in the 9th Congressional District, and all American voters who recognize that the Supreme Court, not the people of the United States, decided this election.
Is the objection signed by a senator?
Unfortunately, Mr. President, it is not signed by one single senator.
Unfortunately, I have no authority over the United States Senate, and no senator has signed.
Mr. President, it is in writing and signed by myself and several of my constituents from Florida. A senator is needed, but missing.
Is the objection in writing and signed by a member of the House and a senator?
The objection is in writing, and I don't care that it is not signed by a member of the Senate.
The chair will advise that the rules do care, and the signature of the senator.
Not a single senator came to the aid of the African Americans in Congress. One after another, they were told to sit down and shut up.
And it's a sad day in America, Mr. President, when we can't find a senator to sign
the
gentleman, objections.
New gentleman will suspend.
Won't sign objections, Mr. President.
The gentleman will suspend.
Now, although those black folk came up in front to speak, when they referred to him as Mr. President, yes, he was the president of the House of Representatives, but they were actually saying he should have been president of the United States. And he knew that. He knew that. He himself, because later on, I think in this clip, he says, even though I disagree with what they did, I accept it. Okay, so the point that I'm getting, here's the point that I want to make. Although he felt that he was cheated out of it, he still stuck to the American way. That's the point. He didn't allow his emotions to be carried away with the Negroes, because the Negroes were like, listen, man, to hell with all that paperwork. They were like, no, we're not. He said, you still got to go with what this is.
Now, the one lady, Maxine Waters, I always liked her. She's the one that said, I don't care if it ain't signed. She's loud spoken, but I do like her. We need to send her a letter. Absolutely. She's got more than sense in the men out there.
Say something else.
Get me Lamentations 4:17. We ain't done yet.
The book of Lamentations, chapter 4, and verse 17. As for us, our eyes is yet failed for our vain help. And our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us.
Y'all see what the Bible prophesies? In our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us. We keep making the same mistake for the past 400 years. that this place is here to save us. You just saw you have no power in Congress. You have no power in the educational system. What are you looking? What pipe dream are you smoking? Read it again.
As for us, our eyes as yet failed for our vain help. In our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us.
There's one savior. That's the black Messiah, Jesus the Christ. We must cry to the Most High in the name of his son. That's it. That's where our help is coming from. And we're going to take it a step down here till the Lord return. But watch this. Give me Isaiah 30 and 1. Isaiah chapter 30 and 1.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 30 and verse 1. Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord.
We are the rebellious. The blacks and Latinos, Native American Indians, those of us that make up the 12 tribes of Israel, we are the rebellious children. Why? Because anytime the Bible comes out, we rebel against it. We rebel, we rebel, we rebel. And we look for politics. We look for some fake religion that was made up. We look for education or economics to save us. Read it again.
Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that take counsel, but not of me.
Because when you take counsel of God, your counsel comes from where? The Bible. Your counsel must be based upon this. But our people, their counsel is not based upon the Bible. Come on.
And that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit.
What does that mean, but cover with a covering, but not of my spirit? We're supposed to cover ourselves with this understanding. But our people go, no, cover me with politics. I want to cover myself with politics or education or economics. That's the way for the black and Latin man. We cover ourselves with things that do not matter, things that have no value in terms of salvation. Read.
That they may add sin to sin.
And by us doing that, we are adding sin to sin. Read.
That walk to go down into Egypt.
What verse you at?
Verse 2.
That walk to go down into Egypt. Egypt. This America, give me the dollar bill, Abiel. Give me the dollar bill because I know we got some new brothers. You might be saying right now, this ain't Egypt. This is spiritual Egypt. Look on the back of your dollar bill. Blow it up, Abiel. Why do they got the pyramid in the eye of all-seeing eye of Ra? Because the Masonic leaders of society, the witches, understand that America is spiritually called Egypt. But it's the black man and Latin man here. We don't understand. We're always confused. This is spiritual Egypt. That's why they have the obelisk in Washington, D.C., here in Central Park as well, and all over the city, in the Vatican also. This place is spiritually called Egypt. Go back to Isaiah 30, Zakai.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 30, and verse 2.
Listen good.
That walk to go down into Egypt.
Now remember, like I said earlier, y'all read this about Egypt, but remember Deuteronomy 28:68, where it used the same word. Give me that, Zakai, so the new people can see it. This is for the new people.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, and verse 68. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
With what?
With ships.
With ships. So this Egypt that God is making reference to is America, because we came here in the Caribbean islands on slave ships. Go ahead.
By the way, whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again.
You won't see your homeland no more again. Come on.
And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies.
Once you got off those slave ships in Egypt, spiritual Egypt, you shall be sold unto your enemies. That happened to us. Come on.
For bond men.
Slave men.
And bond women.
Slave women.
And no man shall buy you.
And no man shall deliver you from your condition. Go back now to Isaiah 30 and 2 again. I wanted to connect that with Isaiah 30 because you'll read this historically. And yes, Israelites did. Some Israelites did try to make a union with ancient Egypt, but it failed. But this is going on a dual level. Read.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 30 and verse 2. That walk and to go down into Egypt and have not asked at my mouth to strengthen themselves in the strength of Pharaoh and to trust in the shadow of Egypt.
Notice it says, and to trust in the shadow of Egypt. Is the shadow the real you? No. Just like the shadow of Egypt, this is not the real Egypt he's talking about. It's the shadow of it. America is the shadow of ancient Egypt. Read.
Therefore shall the strength of Pharaoh be your shame.
This is saying the same thing Jeremiah said in Lamentations. The strength of Pharaoh, meaning the strength of America, the strength of their presidency, shall what?
Be your shame.
Shall be your shame. Go ahead.
And the trust in the shadow of Egypt, your confusion. For his
y'all see that? Do y'all really see this thing? Because our people trust in the political agenda so much. Oh, I'm Democrat. No, you should be Republican. Okay, we're going to be Republicans. It's been almost 400 years. We're still making the same mistakes. It's confusion. That's why it says it shall what?
And the trust in the shadow of Egypt, your confusion.
Your confusion. Jump down to verse 7 and 8.
Verse 7. For the Egyptians shall help in vain.
Right. The Egyptians he's making reference to are the leaders of white society. For the Egyptians shall help you in vain, it says. You want a school system? We'll give you schools. But we're going to poison your kids' mind. You want jobs? We're going to help you with jobs and give a minimum wage. You want homes and houses? We're going to help you. Give them the worst houses. You want medical assistance? Give them the worst medical, Medicaid. That's what they do. Read it again.
For the Egyptians shall help in vain and to no purpose.
And to no purpose. Come on.
Therefore have I cried concerning this. Their strength is to sit still.
God, the Most High God says your strength is to sit still. You know what that means? It means shut up and listen. Because this Bible has been in our care for so long, but we have not sat down and followed what it said. We have not sat down and become still to what it's saying. We're opening, what did Rex Humboldt say? What did Reverend, what's the white guy? Joe Osteen say? What did Paul Kraut say? That's what we do. We will not sit down and say, let me see for myself what God is saying for me. Go ahead.
Now go. Write it before them in a table.
And in case you didn't believe it, the Most High says to the prophet, I want you to write this down. Everything I'm telling you, write it down. Go ahead.
Write it before them in a table and note it in a book.
So the table is the book, which is the Bible. Go ahead.
That it may be for the time to come, forever and ever.
God said, this shall be for the time to come. Meaning during Isaiah's time, that didn't come to pass. But it's happening in this time now. Jump over to verse 12.
Verse 12, wherefore thus saith the Holy One of Israel, because ye despise this word.
Because you despise the laws of God.
And trust in oppression and perverseness.
Our people trust in what?
Oppression and perverseness.
The black man, Latin woman trust in oppression and perversion. Because this whole system, whether it's politics, religion, education, economics, it's all oppression because we get the short end of the stick no matter where we go, no matter how much money we as individuals may have. We trust in oppression and perversion. Was that it? Go ahead.
And stay thereon.
And we stay thereon. Yes.
Oh, I want to tie into the lesson we had 2 weeks ago about the abortions. Now when a young child gets... First of all, they give out the condoms in the health office. Mm-hmm. When they have the promiscuous sex, the girls get pregnant. Now they ship you right to the abortion clinics. The abortion clinics and public school system are like this.
Thank you. And with the police department. Because you do anything wrong, 911, you get called. That's why earlier they were talking about the, what is it called? The school system's pipeline to jail. Right. Okay. Get me the Dan Rather reports. I need y'all to pay close attention. This is called Dan Rather Reports, a National Disgrace. This is about the school system, particularly here in Detroit. But what we're going to read about is going to cover the entire United States.
For decades, blacks and whites had lived in different segregated neighborhoods and gone to their own schools. It was an unspoken segregation. But in 1970, the school board passed a busing plan to desegregate the high schools. Detroit's remaining white population fought the measure, hard, and they weren't alone. The anti-busing fervor rocked the country. In the Detroit suburb of Pontiac, Michigan, 10 school buses were torched and anger spilled out into the streets. Detroit's busing plan was shelved, and the NAACP went to court. Then came a decision that rattled the city. A federal judge ruled that the only way to break down the barriers of race in Detroit's increasingly African-American schools was to use busing to integrate them with dozens of white suburban school districts. The white suburbs revolted, passing resolutions to try to stave off the court order, and the issue became national.
Arguments next in number 73434, Milliken against Bradley.
The landmark case, known as Milliken versus Bradley, reached the Supreme Court in 1974, and in a contentious 5-4 decision, the justices overturned the lower court ruling. There would be no busing between Detroit and her suburbs. The city line became a line of racial divide, separating Detroit's public schools from the mostly white suburban schools.
The court today takes a giant step backwards.
In a stinging dissent, Justice Thurgood Marshall railed against what he saw as systematic injustice.
The Detroit School Board consciously drew school attendance zones along lines which maximized the segregation of races in their schools.
He felt the ruling was a perversion of Brown versus Board of Education, in which the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that school segregation on the basis of race was unconstitutional.
The very evil that Brown was aimed at will not be cured, but will be perpetuated.
And today, more than 50 years after Brown, Detroit's public schools are 88% African American and only 2% white. But race is only part of the story. As Detroit has become poorer and its schools worse, many African Americans who have the means to move elsewhere or send their children to private school have done exactly that.
So, now, I'm glad the reporter, Dan Rather, brought it from the 70s, because when you read about hear about the 70s, a lot of y'all in here go, that doesn't pertain to us today. That's why I said even today. Now, this was done, I think this was 2009. It was around 2009. Let me see. But it happened. It was around, 2009 to 2010. He said, even today, Detroit schools is 88% black and only 2% white. A lot of the whites, they fought that whole busing thing about bus your black kids to white schools. They were like totally against that thing. Now,
did y'all understand what he said? The whole thing about busing was to bus black kids into white areas, into white schools, to get a quote-unquote better education.
Right.
White people was against it. And they set buses on fire and all of that because they were angry about you trying to force niggas into our community. I'm going to just say it plain because that's what they were saying.
Exactly.
And that line around Detroit that used to separate blacks and whites now segregates by economic class as well.
So it's not just white flight. Blacks have left. Black professionals that fear for their children's safety, that want police to come more timely, that want to just walk and enjoy their neighborhood.
And want to have a good school.
They've left.
And that has meant that teachers like Sherry Gay Dagnogo see mostly students from poor homes whose parents themselves have a limited education.
It's disheartening because we know that everybody doesn't come from a perfect setting. Everybody doesn't have a support system in place that ensures their success.
Well, did you have parent-teacher conferences?
Oh, yes.
Were they well attended?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I don't know. I just wish that parents could consider the impact that they have on their children when they're not there and not supporting them.
Did your students, by and large, did they read at grade level or near grade level?
I would venture to say the majority of the class could not read. Thank God we do have audio CDs to let the students listen.
Because they couldn't read the book.
Could not read.
It's all part of a vicious cycle. Children who come from homes where they aren't prepared for education, who then fail in school, and then have children of their own, doomed to repeat the process. That's how you get a city where roughly half of the adult population is functionally illiterate.
In our city, in our community,
I don't know where people get this. They want to mask the truth. It's often stated, don't air our dirty laundry in the public. It's swinging real high. So the dirty laundry is already out there. We have to change the conversation in such a way that it impacts change in our culture.
Well, let's try starting what you would consider to be the necessary new conversation. How does it start?
Being honest about our dropout rate, being honest about our illiteracy rate, being honest about the support that needs to be in place. What mechanisms have to be put in place to make sure we bring a child that's at a third grade reading level to their proper eighth grade, seventh grade reading level?
So she was saying a lot of the kids and the parents were functional illiterates. The blacks that had money moved out of the community. I want you to see how, although you have black people in power, because that's what they put black people, and there was a Puerto Rican woman, I forgot her name is Scott something. She married a black man. But anyway, Ephraim was the head of the board. I want y'all to see how crazy it got. It's, this section is parasites feed off black schools. And pay close attention to what they say about the teachers' union, the contractors, and the school board. Listen.
We can look to other cities where things are being done to address this crisis. And then you come to Detroit, and we're so interested in protecting this, the status quo, so interested in protecting the parasites who feed off of these schools, that we won't change a thing here.
Who are those parasites?
Well, you can start with the teachers' unions, you can start with the contractors, you can start with the school board. The education performance of these children, that's at the bottom of the priority list for these, for the school board and for this city. The political structure of the city is all wrapped up in the school board. You know, their friends have jobs, their spouses have jobs. No one has an incentive to change.
Coming in, I was not given a single document by the school board. Not policy, not a five-year plan, not academic goals, not a budget. I wasn't given any information, so it meant I was starting at ground zero.
We first met Dr. Connie Calloway when she was nearing the end of a tumultuous 18 months as superintendent of the Detroit Public Schools, a tenure marked by fierce fights with Detroit's elected school board.
Well, I heard the superintendent say that she said something back then. I did not hear her say. I called her.
Today, I don't know which side she's working for. I raised the same question. That is what I said in the back room.
From the beginning, Dr. Calloway says she found a district operating dishonestly and without accountability. When you got there, what shocked you most about the Detroit schools?
The complete absence of any process or organization. For example, when I got there, the district was overinflating its enrollment by between 5 and 10,000 students. And over the past years, Detroit has gone from 300,000 students to its current enrollment of 95,000. They lose between 5 and 10,000 students per year.
So they brought in Dr. Calloway to try to fix up the Detroit school system. She saw a total breakdown in everything. There was no organization at all. And remember, the board members are all black and Latino. Watch what happens.
Public schools are funded by your tax dollars. If a district lies about its numbers, they get more money. So inflating enrollment is a form of fraud. And an honest accounting meant Calloway would have to make cuts.
And for at least 2 years, Detroit had not maintained a staff seniority list. So how does one know who should be the first to be laid off? And that complete absence of fundamental systems and organization was a shock to me.
Calloway told us she was determined to channel that shock into action. But first, she needed a detailed picture of the school district, one based on hard facts. And the picture she got back was ugly. She found the district was still paying expensive utility bills on shuttered schools years after they'd been closed. She discovered test scores in writing had declined by an alarming 23% over a three-year period. And she was shocked to find that there had been no evaluations of district employees for more than a decade.
Calloway's findings totaled almost 1,400 pages. She felt she now had what she needed to begin to make a change in DPS.
This notebook provides the baseline data that I never received. It is a building profile of every single school in the district, with the number of students, with the attendance. It is an evaluation form. All of the employees in the district were evaluated.
But when she handed out copies to members of the school board, she says most of them didn't seem to care about what she'd found.
In looking in hindsight at the barriers, at the obstacles that were thrown in my path, I believe it was chaos by design.
Chaos is one thing. Chaos by design is another thing.
Yes, indeed.
She said, this is chaos by design. You have all these leaders that over that, but and they see what's going on. They didn't give a damn. That's the same thing. What's happening there is the same thing here in New York and all from city to city, state to state. It's chaos by design. That's what we've been showing you from the beginning of this lesson, even up until here. I want you to pay close attention.
Who designed this chaos and why?
It's been years in the making, Mr. Rather. I don't think that it happened just with this board. I think that this board carried on business the way that it had been done.
This meeting is called to order. This meeting is being held pursuant to Section 5.2 of the employment contract between the board and Dr. Calloway.
Calloway and the school board clashed from the start, and in December 2008, the board voted to terminate her contract. This public hearing was held 2 months later.
Let's put this as directly as possible. In your judgment and based on your experience, why were you fired after only 18 months on the job in Detroit?
They bottom line said, she's changing too much, she's interfering with our money, and they said to me, you interfere with our money, we'll interfere with yours.
Her termination hearing was a formality. But in front of a packed room of supporters and activists, Dr. Calloway was determined to throw all of her frustrations back at the school board.
I fought desperately for this district. 70% of my time was spent jumping through hoops with the Board of Education. The board approved this program when we are in deficit and we don't have funds and don't have textbooks. To this day, I have no idea what the board's budget is. And they shut me down. I was not allowed to speak at board meetings. They put their hands in my face. They gaveled me. They called me out of my name. It's...
Thank you. Thank you.
When she came in, I thought she was awesome. I thought she was the best thing that happened to this district since my children have started going to school. And, you know, when they got rid of her, I just lost. I lost all hope after that.
Now that the testimony has been concluded, that concludes this hearing. Thank you.
I feel like they didn't want her here because she had exposed some of the things that were going on, and especially when it came to that money.
It was you all, it was this district that robbed these kids of their education. The payroll person needs to be locked up. Need to be locked up. You can't tell me whoever it was, didn't know 500 people was not budgeted. Ridiculous.
The educational experience is not that great. I mean, the kids don't come to class on time, and like, we use like 25 minutes out of the class to get the class to shut up anyway.
We first met Deanna Williams in the winter of her junior year outside Henry Ford High School. Sadly, in many ways, it's a typical school in Detroit. Attendance is spotty, the graduation rate is low, and test scores suggest almost no students are performing anywhere near grade level.
So I don't really see the point of being here, but I'm here because I want to go to college, and I don't see how this is going to prepare me for college.
What is your dream? What do you want to do with your professional life?
I want to be a librarian and a writer. That is all I have ever wanted to do since I was little. Something to do with books.
Well, that's not so wild a dream.
To some, it might not be, but it's my dream.
Well, what are you doing to prepare yourself for that? You said you read a lot.
I certainly do. Last year, I helped out in the library on my free periods.
I used to code and shelf books, check out books, and like search for lost books. It was like the most fun I had ever had in my life.
You got to pause it right there. He asked her, what are you, she says she wants to be a what? Librarian. He says, what are you doing to prepare yourself? She says she worked in a library. That school maybe got 5 books on the shelf. Is that preparing her? Where would she have to go to really prepare herself to be a librarian? Let's start there. Do you know where she would have to go? What is the largest library in the United States? Library of Congress. You'd have to go there. Then you got Britain has the largest one, the British, I forgot the name of it, but they got the largest one in Britain. Those are the places, if you're preparing yourself, you have to go. He ain't gonna tell her that. Nobody in the school gonna tell her that. Her preparing herself in a rinky-dink library with 5 books is not preparing you for nothing. That's why we're saying we get the worst of everything.
And you like to write?
Yes. I write all the time. It's like getting my thoughts down on paper so I don't have to think about them anymore. Mm-hmm. It's like dredging up old memories is really tiring. It's like I just wrote it down. Do I really have to tell you again?
This part here is a football player. Some of you young boys want to get into sports. Watch what he says.
If we ever doubted the truthfulness of student reports about what happens inside Detroit public schools, his matter-of-fact list of what these graduates had endured during their 4 years at Finney certainly made us pay attention.
Students have died tragically, but we all stayed together, and we all made it through. I congratulate this senior class.
In an effort to keep students in and violence out, Finney High School had taken the drastic step of building a chain-link fence around the entire school building. The symbolism was not lost on the students.
It's pointless because I look at it like they locking us in. Like we have no type of freedom.
It's like we're animals. You cage us in like animals, they gonna act like animals.
You know? That's how they act. But by putting a cage around Finney, it's making them think like, well, that's a representation of how they feel about us.
We met brothers Darius and DeMarco Kraft when they were students at Finney. They were both star football players, and they told us it was their devotion to the team that kept them coming to school every day.
DeMarco Kraft!
DeMarco was one of the graduates of this class. He went on to Alabama State University, but he told us he wasn't sure his high school diploma truly signified academic accomplishment.
I don't feel that we're being prepared for college as to the best of our abilities. I think it could be a lot more done. We could succeed higher if we were to get better in education, but it's mediocre. It'll get you by, you know.
The boys told us that many of their teachers just recited lessons from worksheets and textbooks, and that the students had few chances for any hands-on learning.
You might get that one teacher of English class, right. She may give you one essay. But like a lot of schools, you have essays for every class, like biology, you might have a science project or something. But no science. I've never done a science project since I've been in Finney.
There's certain stuff in the classroom we can't even touch, and it's supposed to be for the class. But people steal like scissors or tweezers. And I done one experiment in chemistry, and we didn't even finish.
A chemistry class without a single lab. That wouldn't be allowed in most high schools. But in Detroit, the students we talked to seem resigned to the reality of the way their schools are run.
Now you heard him say the students have very little with hands-on learning. Hands-on learning. That's how you learn. You got to be hands-on. Yes, Levi in the back. I want y'all to stay with me. I know some of y'all might be bored in here, but just stay alive. Stay alive. It's going to help you out.
You see what that brother just said right there. When I was in high school, I came from Haiti. I came here 15 years old. Mm-hmm. I never really did any type of hard work because in Haiti, you were trained very rigorously to study, to analyze, to do all type of stuff. So when I got here, high school was easy for me. Mm-hmm. So I made it through high school with a breeze and they chose a select few of us to take calculus. Calculus in college is a basic course. And the few of us that chose to take calculus, was only taking it to take a test. You did not really learn anything, just to take a test. So when I made it to college, the basics that we needed to learn in high school were not there. We were taking it in college. Mm-hmm. That's why many, many of students you see graduated there.
Yeah.
They were going to drop in college. First year, second year, then they out.
Right.
That's the whole trick. They don't get you in high school, they get you in college.
You see that? Y'all got to really see this thing for what it is. A lot of, yes, Zakai.
I just want to add on to what he said. Because that kid is a football player, they're going to put him in remedial classes. So those classes that he's missing, they're going to give it to him. It's going to be like he's in 11th grade. And they're going to run him through there and get him to where he needs to be just so he can be on that field. So.
He's 100% right on that, because they'd rather do that than to lose that star athlete that will make that school big business.
That's right.
When it comes to those games that they play.
That's right.
The only incentive that they have is to make money off of them. If they had an incentive on our education, they would do more, but they have no incentive because they don't want us to be where we need to be.
Those of you all that are from the islands, you all experience this. The educational system here in America is very low to the educational system in the islands. All right, because when you go to the education you got over there is on a higher level than up here. A lot of kids, when they come up here and they go to high school up here from the islands, a lot of them usually excel all the kids on them. That's in this educational system up here. You understand? Because in the islands, the educational level is on another level. You know? And that's and even if it's on another level, when you come up here, what America say? They say, listen, you got to go back one more form. You know, like if you was in the 11th grade in the islands, when you come up here, they taking you back in the 10th grade, like your educational level is less than America. Right. You understand? But when really and truly your level is above the education in America. Because in the islands, they don't teach over there that Christopher Columbus discovered the islands. In the history and the textbook, they say he rediscovered. You understand? And they teach you about the people that was living there and so forth. It's only in America that push these lies and destroy the minds of our people.
Mm-hmm. Hands-on experience. That's what the guy said. There's no real hands-on experience, which ties in to what the young lady said when she said she wants to be a librarian. He says, what are you doing to prepare yourself? She says, oh, I go to my library with 5 books in there. That's not hands-on. That's not real hands-on experience. We as a people, and when I say our people, I'm talking about the masses of our people. We're not, like we went to the video earlier, he said we are in school, which are centers of propaganda, right? Y'all remember that? We are taught to be wage slaves. I don't know. I went to art school. I think Bezalel, you went to art school. Josiah, and I think a couple of the sisters, my wife, went to art school. When I went to visual arts, and they were teaching us a lot, you know, art, different things. But I noticed the school was primarily white, and it's what they did was they would have trips to take you to see the better artists in other countries. And we didn't have the money. I didn't have my parents, you ain't got no money to go flying out there. But Esau, whose families had the money, went and flew here, flew there, and all of this. Like, in the, give me, okay. You see this garment here, right? You got brothers and sisters that go to school for fashion, right? Say, oh, I know how to draw this, blah, 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 which is fine. But Esau's children were taken on the next level. They'll say, no. It's not good enough for you to know how to draw. You got to know where they make these raw materials from. We're going to take you to places like India and China and build a network from there to here with you. Black kids and Latin kids, we don't go through that. We don't know who to talk to on the other side of the world or what. Or the people who like his sisters know how to sew and cut, they cut. But with Esau, they have people that have machines that cut these things out like that, bam, 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 and have industrial laborers do this. We're not at that level yet. Even food, I was asking my son the other day, he wants to go into cooking. There was a woman on TV, they said, what makes your cooking that much better than everyone else? So I asked my son. And she said, it's all about the quality of the food. So most people say, I say, where are you going to get your food from? Associated or Walmart. Mm-mm. Esau will have farms. They will go to places that produce fresh food. Y'all understand the difference between their education and ours? Ours is just as far as our nose on our face. That's it. Esau's stretch is long. His arm is long. And that's how they keep things. The money is rolling and the money is deep and long. Whereas us, it's not like that. Yes, Joel.
To add on in the educational system, in college, there's a class where they required us to watch a documentary. So I'm saying from the fifth grade to sixth grade, they had the little Caucasian students doing hands-on activities, like with the math problems that they learned. They have them go out and build the playground. With even reading, with writing, they have them write letters to the Congress about what's going on. So they're doing hands-on, even in terms of like credit cards, finances, how to cook. They bring them each year or every week to a institution where they have the kids go, okay, shop. Okay, how do you, how much money you save? You know, or how do you cook? Or how do you apply this credit to this? So these, they training them from youth, right, how to survive in society and how to benefit themselves.
Exactly.
Right.
Good point. Let me say one thing on that. Okay. When I was in high school, they gave, this was in the 80s, they gave every one of us a Visa, MasterCard, and American Express. You give these credit cards to little black and white because we ain't never had none. Guess what we did? We went crazy. We spent our credit, and we didn't understand credit or none of that. There was nobody there. Like Joel was saying, how little white kids, when they're young, they take them shopping and show them how to budget. We are not taught that. We just spend. So I want those sneakers. I want that shirt. I want this. I want that. That's how we're brought up. They train us to be consumers. Consumers, that's all we are, consumers. That's why they call us liquid money.
I wanted to make the point about what the elder was speaking about and what Joel was talking about with the kids in the school. No, you mentioned about your son, with the cooking thing. In white America, or in the other nations, when they go to school, they don't only just learn about what kind of meats to bring in and the farm. They learn about the whole agricultural business. He's just supposed to be going to school just for cooking. But what they do, they give you, let me just use this word, they give him a holistic education, which involves different parts of whatever he's going to be into. Not only are you going to learn the business aspect of running the company, but you're going to also know the whole science behind the agricultural part that brings the food in. You're not only going to know about the animals, where the food grow, and all the, you know, and all that stuff. You're going to know how the business operates in that. So they give you a holistic kind of thing, and that right there trains you not only to simply be a worker, you'll be over the damn industry. That's how they teach them to be over the industry.
Right. They teach us just to be a simple wage worker, but Esau will run the company because they know the ins and outs and all of that. Now we don't know.
Right. Now I'm gonna give you an example. Years ago, I told you about this here. Years ago, I watched this program that was on Channel 13, and it was about the Sony Corporation, the electronics corporation out of Japan. And there was a video article about how they rebuilt themselves after they were bombed with Nagasaki and Hiroshima. So they themselves made an agreement or took an oath that they were going to rebuild themselves, and they invested in their own resources. Let me show you what they did. Not only were they teaching the kids on how to build up their companies, they were actually interact with the companies that were already there. Getting back to the point that you were making about how the kids are exposed, like we're speaking about the girl with the library. She's talking about learning how to be a librarian. She's dealing with five books. When white people talk about going to be librarians, they go to the Library of Congress. They go to those big, those world huge libraries and deal with all kinds of different subjects that's related to that, a holistic education. Going back to the part about the electronic situation with Sony, they had their kids in grade school talking to the CEO of Sony. They brought the man from Sony himself down into the classroom to speak to the students. I'm showing you because they want to bring that connection. No, we don't just want you on the assembly line. We want you to build Sony corporations. We want you to build your own corporations. That's the huge difference between the education that's supposed to be given to our kids that are not being given to our kids. So I say all of that to reflect back on that first video that we saw. The educational system, point blank, is designed to make you factory workers, wage earners.
It's not fair that you see kids in Southfield and Waterford and all this, and they have computers in their classrooms, and they have new textbooks I've never even seen before. And I go to the biggest district, and they can't even afford to give us a quality education or the kind of education that other kids are getting. And it's frustrating to know that I can be learning all of these things, and I can be doing all of these things, and I can't. And people think that the children in Detroit Public Schools are stupid and brutish because of what they see on television. And it's not true. We want to learn. We want to be able to do what the other children are doing. We want to have the same opportunities, but they keep taking them away from us. It's like they're keeping us down. And then you find out that the people who are supposed to be looking after us, after our well-being, they're stealing from us. And every day I want to know why. Why is this happening?
Do y'all hear this? That will move you to tears. That's why we have brothers, sisters, we have a very big job to do. Things like this just frustrates me, but it inspires me to push on. And I pray it does the same. Get Sirach 38:34. Let me show you what the school system prepares for.
The book of Sirach, chapter 38, verse 34. But they will maintain the state of the world, and all their desire is in the work of their craft.
Right. The purpose of graduating, getting these degrees, is to maintain the state of this world. All those graduates in the educational system, they get like the, who did we see? What's the black man's name we saw? Dennis Walcott, John King Jr. When they graduated with high degrees, they went put back in there to support the system, to keep it running, keep it alive, and keep this whole breeding ground of dumb blacks and Latinos going. That's what's going on. From there, go to Daniel chapter 1. We read this before about when they noticed that in what they call the urban areas, a smart black or a smart Latino, they quickly take note of you and separate you. Get me that in Daniel 1, verse 3 and 4, please.
Right. The book of Daniel chapter 1, verse 3. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs.
Listen good.
That he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans.
So y'all see that? That happened under Babylon. So this is where America gets it from. They notice that in the urban areas, they take note of certain blacks and Latinos that stand out far and beyond, like Obama. When you read a book about him, they said he stood out in his class. They quickly separated him and gave him a scholarship and said, listen, we're going to use this guy to further our agenda. That's what they do. So you might ask yourself, well, what can we do to prevent these things? Get Esther 10. And verse 3, because the Bible has the answers. Because although Daniel and his three Israelite buddies, Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael, they was on a high learning, you had Esther and Mordecai to look what the Bible says about Mordecai. Chapter 10, verse 3.
The book of Esther, chapter 10, and verse 3. For Mordecai the Jew was next unto King Ahasuerus, and great among the Jews, and accepted of the multitude of his brethren, seeking the wealth of his people and speaking peace to all his seed.
You see what he did with all his learning, his education, his influence? He sought the what? Read that again, Zakai.
For Mordecai the Jew was next unto King Ahasuerus.
He was second to the king in Persia. Go ahead.
And great among the Jews.
Watch this.
And accepted of the multitude of his brethren, seeking the wealth of his people.
He sought the wealth of his people, meaning the Israelites. Read.
And speaking peace to all his seed.
And spoke peace unto all his seed. That's why it's imperative that we constantly get this word out. You never know who the word is going to touch as people are walking by or on YouTube. It may be our people who are of great influence, who hear, like when you read during the time of Christ, Nicodemus was a man of great influence. Who else? Who else? Joseph of Arimathea. He was rich. Zacchaeus, he was a tax collector, said when they heard this truth, those men quickly repented and used their influence to help the Israelites. That's why don't look down on what we do, because this truth is what's going to awaken the nation. And our people that do have great influence and great resources, they're going to repent and be guided to use it the proper way for the benefit of our people. Y'all understand that? Get me Sirach chapter 29. Like I said earlier, blacks, we have over 100 black colleges and institutions. Over 100 of our people who have these degrees. Where are they? They've been trained improperly. I'm not saying all of them, because you will find a few of them who are entrepreneurs. Okay, but watch this. Sirach 29 and 21. Watch this.
The book of Sirach, chapter 29, verse 21. The chief thing for life is water and bread and clothing and a house to cover shame. Better is the life of a poor man in a mean cottage.
All I want is 21, Zakai.
Oh, sorry.
Read 21 again. I'm going to see who pick up.
The chief thing for life is water and bread and clothing and a house to cover shame.
So God named four of the chief things in life. If our people went to school and learned about those four chief things in life, those are the four main things you need to maintain a society of people. Read it again, Zakai. I want you to listen to what he's saying.
The chief thing for life is water.
You need water. Go ahead.
And bread.
You need bread goes into food. That's what it's talking about. Go ahead.
And clothing.
And you need clothes to cover your body.
And in house to cover shame.
And you need house to cover. Those are the four main things that when our kids go to school, these are the four main things they should look at. But you know what our people do? They go to college and say, I want to get into literature. Let me read Shakespeare. Let me watch The White Man. Romeo, oh Romeo, wherefore art thou? Romeo, I am here, Juliet. Juliet, here am I cometh for thee. What in the hell is that going to sustain the people? So you graduate. Now you're standing there like, I don't know what to do. Because all that literature, that stuff. Read it again, Zakai, so we can look at this thing.
The chief thing for life is water and bread and clothing and in house to cover shame.
Those are the four main things, God said. But he says something else. Watch this. Go to Sirach 39. Chapter 39, verse 26.
The book of Sirach.
Wait. Let me get it. Dang. Where you at? 39:26. Okay, go ahead, Zakai.
The book of Sirach, chapter 39, verse 26. The principal things for the whole use of man's life.
Listen good.
Are water, fire, iron, and salt, flour of wheat, honey, milk, and the blood of the grape, and oil, and clothing.
Y'all see that? So the Most High is saying with this verse and the previous verse, if we can learn that, you can sustain a society. That's what the Most High is saying. Because when you look at things like, look at iron. You can do a lot of things with iron, a lot of things with water, salt, flour, clothing. What else is that? I can't barely see. Milk, right. The blood of the grape. All these things, when Esau go to school and learn about the grape. We sitting in college with him going, you dumb. What you learn about the grape for? He go, yeah, okay, I'll be that dummy. The white man is going to Italy learning how to grow vineyards and make wineries. Making millions upon millions of dollars. You know what I'm saying? This is the mindset where the keys to everything is right here. Who had the hand? If somebody had the hand, yes.
When I read this in conjunction with Esther 10 and 3, where it says the wealth of our people, I see things like where it says water, That's going into irrigation systems.
Mm-hmm.
When I see the word bread, that's going into farming. That, and when I see words like clothing, that's going into textile industry. When I see things like the house cover shame, that's going into real estate.
Right.
And then the steel, that's going into construction. Exactly. So those are the fields that we got to get our children into.
That's what I was thinking.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, man, then believe it or not, these fields are controlled. You can control. You can control. The Our Forefather can control this field. Because we mango in the American, we want to be just like whatever they give us, we bear with it. Man, but what most I want us to understand, these things is enough to build a nation.
Yep.
If each of us decide, because what's so wrong about our society, like Deacon Malachi said, is a fear within our people. They are afraid to take a chance. They are afraid to sacrifice themselves for the nation. A lot of us, we selfish. You understand? Because we have to give. It's a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice to better your people. Look at Moses. Look at Christ. Look at the rest of our forefathers. They sacrificed themselves for the nation. That's the state we have to come. And like me and Shem talk, I saying that you can reveal that to all chick, but we need brothers and sisters in the same mind frame.
Right.
You understand? We need to be in the same mind frame. You understand? You can open that. But if you have many brothers, many sisters who's in a selfish will, you're going to have a problem down the line. That's why this class is very important, man. We have to sacrifice ourselves for our children. Really, that's what we're doing. You understand?
Right. One of the things that I want to mention, I've been wanting to bring this piece out pretty much during the class, but it seemed to come up at the right time now. Because Deacon Malachi made the point about fear is the reason why we don't do things. One of the things that promotes this atmosphere of fear is how we see ourselves. Okay? And this is where the video department, I'll just speak about that in particular. We have the power through video to change the image of ourselves. Because that's really what the problem is. When you think about the problem of or the scripture that we speak about, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If we have a particular image in our mind about ourselves, it's already self-negating. If you don't have the proper image of yourself, I want to just talk about that for just a moment. Put up Tom Burrell's Brainwashed. Now, before you play it, there was a movie about a white family that adopted this big black kid.
Yeah, what was the name of that? Sandra Bullock. Right. Starting it, Blindside.
Blind, right. That's the name of it? Okay, because he makes reference. I didn't see the movie, but I knew what he was talking about. So this person makes Tom Burrell, I guess he's the one that's being interviewed. You're going too far. It's in the beginning. He makes reference to this video. I need y'all to listen carefully. Play it.
Tom Burrell is an advertising, marketing, and communications pioneer who founded one of the first black-owned and operated advertising firms in this country nearly 40 years ago. He is now chairman emeritus of Burrell Communications, which has finally given Mr. Burrell the time to write his first book. It's called Brainwashed, Challenging the Myth of Black Inferiority. That it is through marketing, primarily,
mm-hmm.
that this brainwashing has taken hold. So for those persons watching who don't want to deal with that 400-year narrative
mm-hmm.
about the brainwashing, let's make it more contemporary.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to me about how the media, about how marketing, about how advertising has led to this brainwashing.
So he made the point of bringing out a book. He wants to talk about the issue of black inferiority. This goes back to images. This is the reason why I'm bringing this up. Talk about the imagery on which we see ourselves. So he's going to make the point.
It is now on automatic.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the movies that were nominated for the Academy Award, I'll bet you can go through half of them and find a whole slew of cues, a visual and verbal cues that reinforce the idea of black inferiority, white supremacy. Which one you want to take? You want to take the blind side?
Mm-hmm.
The black family throws the kid away. In comes this wonderful white family who embraces this big, oafish kind of kid who, you know, doesn't know anything, big, mm-hmm. gentle giant. Then we see him going into his neighborhood with this woman who is his new mother, and it's a menacing place, and she's gonna get out of the car, and he grabs her in. Don't get out. These are some dangerous people out there. And then you see the most menacing group of black guys that mm-hmm. you can imagine, you know, and you see in their eyes, you see, you know, thuggishness, and you see these potential rapists, you know, and there is no positive black family image portrayed, you know, whatsoever. But you have this sharp contrast between good and bad and white and black. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that white families haven't adopted black kids, mm-hmm. but you know something? Black families have adopted black kids. And you have to ask yourself the question, would that be a movie?
Now, here's the point that I want to make. What we get our idea of ourselves from television, from the images that pops up over the television. And television is a one-way communication device. Let's just look at the name, the word television itself. It tells a vision of someone else who's controlling television. So your concept of yourself is being fueled and forged by what you see on television, because you don't get to tell television what to do. Television tells you what to do. Television tells you how to think. Television gives you your opinion. You run around talking about, I got my own opinion. If your television breaks down, you have no opinion. That's how most of our people are. So the point that I'm making is that the images that we have of ourselves is what's been given to us through the people that control television. He gives you his vision of yourself. Now, think about a mirror. I'm going to show you how deep it goes. Think about a mirror. You have a mirror in your house, right? Y'all with me? When you look at yourself, I'm talking to the women too. When you look at yourselves in the mirror, there's a particular image that you want reflected back from the looking glass. If our image of ourselves is being shaped by television, we expect to see that when we look at ourselves in the mirror. Are y'all with me? When we are going and we have a checklist. You say, my hair looks good, this looks good, my tie is. And then you get to the point where you said, that's it, I've got the look. What look did you actually agree with? The look that conforms to your psychological self, which was fed to you by television. Are y'all with me? Y'all understand what I'm saying? The image that you have of yourself has been shaped by television. The image that you have of your own self is shaped by those who do not have your best interests at heart. So when you see yourself, you don't see yourself as you, because we don't really have anything as a people that really points out to who we actually are. Our actual base, our actual photo album, all of those things are forgotten. We have become a new people, a new made people who were made by the people who control television. So that's what we look for when we look at the mirror. We hope to see what we hope to reinforce what we believe we are based on what has been projected to us. Are y'all all right? Here's the importance of why I say what we need to do. Give me the book of Zephaniah 2 and 1. Zephaniah 2 and 1. This is how we do it.
Book of Zephaniah, chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together. Yea, gather together, O nation not desired.
Gather yourselves together. Gather together, O nation not desired. We are not desired, but the scriptures say for us to gather together. So among us, there are particular talents, there are particular resources that are ours. But we will not use those talents. We will not use those resources. Why? Because we don't think that we are worthy. We don't think that we are gifted enough to know how to harness those God-given talents to work for our people. We don't have that. We don't have that image of ourselves. So what can we do to change that image? We were talking about getting rid of the fear of schools. We were talking about doing other things that needs, like Officer Solomon is bringing out. All of these things, the beginning of that is how you see yourself. That's where it all begins. That's why would the scriptures say, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. You have to first change this. What's going to help us change what's in our minds? We have to have a better image of ourselves. The image of ourselves comes from us putting out the image for our people to see. That's the importance of video. As we begin to put those positive images out about ourselves, about our history, about our forefathers, show those images. You got some people running around talking about images are not important. Are you crazy? Image is everything. Image is everything. And the Lord gave us the tools. He gave us the way through the computers, through the online, through the public access shows. We got ways to get the image out there. We cannot be fearful. Get rid of that spirit. We can't be fearful and not do this. We must do it for our own selves and for our families and children. We have to do it. As men, we have to do it. Do y'all understand that? So that's the importance. I'm paying particular attention to putting out, like these brothers that do the marvelous work of the video. Y'all really don't, I don't know if y'all really understand the magnanimous and autonomous weight of what you're doing. You're breaking down years and layers of destructive imagery with that work that you brothers are doing. Okay? Go ahead.
Raise up your hands, those of y'all that first heard of us from YouTube. That's the work right there. And if you go out of state, almost everybody out of state, a vast majority of them is from the videos or for YouTube. Just little works like that. You understand? That's how much your work is value. You understand? Exactly. But as we was talking about the fear, all right, a lot of brothers inside here, you all got gifts. But a lot of times brothers if I quit my job or if I give up this job and I try doing my own business, I mightn't succeed. What I gonna do? You understand? Things like this run through brothers' mind. That's why that's that fear that Esau programming you, that you need him to survive in this economy. You understand? But what you could do is take small steps and say, listen, all right, I'm going to start my own business. I ain't going to quit my job as yet. You know, I'm going to wait till I build myself up. Then I'm going to leave that job and stop depending and maintaining this society. You know, and then I could bring brothers to work with me. And so forth, I'm built from there. But that's where the fear starts. Same thing with the sisters. You understand? You all gotta, don't be scared. Oh, because, you know, I ain't finished high school. I tell you all straight. I ain't finished high school. I ain't ashamed of that. Because I meet some people that went to high school and they dumb. I finished high school, went to college, got bachelors and all of that, and they dumb as hell. I'm telling you all straight. And you all meet some of them. They dumb as hell. You be talking to them, they just dumb. They so educated that they dumb. They so educated in Esau's system that they dumb, man. You know, so that didn't say nothing. You know, but what I'm saying, brothers, you all could, as y'all was upset, you all got, we got to stop maintaining the state of this society and this world. Mm-hmm. You sisters, stop being fearful and start homeschooling your kids. All right? And bring them out of Esau's school system. The other day, El, I told you I sit down with Ezekiel principal. All right, so he's a black woman. A black woman is the principal. So she telling me, she like, they already know Ezekiel is an Israelite. He don't follow because every high holiday I keep them home. So she said, why you don't come here with Ezekiel for y'all could come to the school, we having a holiday party, which was Thanksgiving. I said, listen. I said, on these days, you know, I keep Ezekiel home. She said, it's just a Thanksgiving party, you know, it's for him to get along with the kids and all of that, you know. But the point is, I keep stressing to the principal and the teacher, listen, when you are throwing these things, let me know so I keep my son home. And you know what? They still pushing it on him, yo. They still pushing it on him. The last, every Christmas time, you know, every Christmas time, they're trying to push toys on him. That's why I give him toys for Hanukkah, so he ain't going to have that urge to take that thing. But they still push it on him. You understand? So we got to understand what's going on in these school system, and we got to, this school system is designed to destroy our kids, and we got to take them out, man. Right. We got to take them out because a lot of us going to lose our kids in the school system. A lot of our kids going to follow peer pressure and a lot of these wickedness that's going on in this school, and they're going to be destroyed through the school system, man.
Right. I'm going to be real quick. I want to say this before I forget. There's a book entitled The Miseducation of the Negro. It's by this brother named Carter G. Woodson. And he makes the point in the book. I need y'all to listen. He makes the point in the book on how the so-called Negro was his mind has been reshaped to the point where he has a negative image of himself. This is the reason why I say this. The negative image of him, right, this is the man here. The negative image of himself, this is what they say. When you control a man's thinking, remember I made the point about as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Y'all with me? Yes, sir. He said, when you control a man's thinking, you do not have to control, you don't have to tell him what to do. You don't have to tell him to go here or go there. You don't have to tell him, you don't have to guess what his actions will be because you already know that. You can tell him that if you train him to go to the back door at every time he enters into a building, after a while, he will always look for that back door, even though the front door is wide open. He will walk past the front door and go around the back, and if there is no back door, he will make one rather than go around the front door. Okay? I point that out to show you how important imagery is. Because once you give the people that kind of image of themselves, they will do just that. They will go and look for a back door, even if there isn't one, rather than go through the front door.
Exactly.
That's the importance of us being able. We ourselves have to shape our people's minds.
Right. I want to jump right on that. Get second Ezra 14.
There it is up there.
34. This is going to tie right in what Deacon Yahusup said and what this guy caught it. Now, Carter G. Woodson said this in 1933. And then you can see there's really been no change until now. Until you, brothers and sisters. Read that, Zakai.
The book of 2 Ezra, chapter 14, verse 34. That's what you wanted, right?
Yep.
Therefore, if so be that you will subdue your own understanding and reform your hearts.
So what is that saying? Just that part. That's all I want right there. Hananiah, tell us, what is the Most High have Ezra to teach us there?
We got to change our way of thinking. We got to come up with the thoughts of this world, the things we've been programmed with. We got to reprogram our minds.
Exactly. Because that, I want y'all to hold that. Now get Isaiah 55.
Okay. The book of
and we're going right back to Ezra, Zakai. We're going right back there.
All right. The book of Isaiah, chapter 55 and verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither or your ways, my ways, saith the Lord.
So we have not been brought up in society to think according to God's ways. That's why when we bring out the Bible, what do people on the street say? That ain't in the Bible. That's racist. That's not in the Bible. Why? Because every one of us have been conditioned to what America has wanted us to think, to feel, but God says your thoughts are not mine. So now in us being born again, because that's what 2 Ezra is talking. Read that again now, 2 Ezra 13, 34.
Book of 2 Ezra, chapter 14, verse 34.
Chapter 14, verse 34. Thank you.
14, verse 34. Therefore, if so be that you will subdue your own understanding.
Meaning, forget all that you learned in America. Forget it. It's garbage. Everything you've learned from elementary school to college has been garbage. Everything that you've learned on television has been garbage. Subdue your own understanding, read.
And reform your hearts.
Reform your hearts means change your thinking according to what God is saying. Reform your hearts to what this is saying. Then will your thoughts be God's thoughts. Go ahead.
Ye shall be kept alive.
Then you shall have eternal life. That's what it means to be kept alive. Go ahead.
And after death.
And after death, meaning the destruction that's coming on this place.
Ye shall obtain mercy.
You shall obtain mercy. So our thoughts really have to be transformed. Us being born again really got to go to the next level. Right. That's why, like Deacon Yahusup was saying, the video department, you don't really understand the power God has put in your hands. The brothers and sisters who have woken up just through that, many of you go, it ain't nothing. You don't understand what you're in. Yeah, I'm tired. I'm lazy. I want to eat chicken. You don't understand the power God has put in your hands. You take this as a joke, but the white man does. What do you think these movies are about? Thor. What are the other movies they got up there? Thor, The Avengers. That's not about blacks and Latinos coming together. That's to inspire whites to come together and do what they're going to do. What are some of these other movies they got coming out? Noah, that's another one. Son of God, that's another one coming out. Hercules, thank you, that's another one. All that is white supremacy on the next level. So you brothers, like you Josiah in the video, y'all are taking this for a joke. You have to step it up because we are at war. Give me that scripture in Ephesians. You know it is. We wrestle not that one. It's not a physical war. It's not that. This is spiritual. All these brothers that woke up from YouTube, the ones online, you have no idea the power God has put in your hands. Just us bringing up this truth. Come on.
The book of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
Right. This is not a fist fight. Go ahead.
But against principalities.
But again, we are fighting against principalities with this Bible. That's what we're fighting against. Principalities. Go ahead.
Against powers. Against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Against spiritual wickedness in high places.
We are fighting against spiritual wickedness in high places. We showed you one level with the educational system. What y'all going to do about it? This is just one level what we're going over here in the Sabbath class. The 7 day a week online, that's another level. But there's more levels we can go to. If you brothers and sisters who got your degrees and whatever no understandings you got will not be afraid to take the next step. Right, music included. Yes. Come on, where's the mic?
A while back, I actually posted some links because I was looking around for free courses, college courses online. And I was posting it on Facebook because they have stuff like KhanAcademy.org and websites like that where you can take your kids from all curriculums, from kindergarten, for like math, stuff like math, science, anything you want, and you can homeschool your kids from that up to college. I found a whole website dedicated to free college courses where you can even train yourself to do stuff like, I even found one that they teach you how a city is designed. So I got those links, and I've been downloading some videos. So there's the information. It's just that Israel's lazy,
right,
scared.
And this is not about us wanting to live here for the next 100 years. This is not that, because you'll get these dummies online, oh, they want to stay here. Our mindset is to leave. But we understand before we leave, the Most High wants to take us to the next level of understanding. We understand that much, okay? So with that, I'm going to close. Any questions or anything y'all want to bring out? Yeah, yes, Baba. Yeah,
you know, you're not focused. Because when you're looking at on YouTube, right, the image the white man has put on our people, man, anytime you see a black man, he's a fealty. Because the white man showing the other nation something wrong with us. You understand? We have to bring our image back up. You understand? Our image been destroyed being a black man. You understand? So your guys who behind this video, you bringing an image back to life. You bringing the nations, the face of an Israelite man. You bring it back to life, but you don't see the power you have to your laziness. You know what I mean? Because on YouTube is one thing you're going to find out on YouTube. You don't think these men, you don't think these nation watching? You don't think they're watching? Yeah, I remember when we was in Connecticut, I keep saying that. We had a phone where a guy, one of the guy answered the phone. Then the guy in the other end explained to the guy who he was, where he lived, who his mother is, where his dad. He said, who's that? You understand? They're watching. You understand? Maybe we don't have nothing, like Christ said. Everything we speak is going to be in the light. We don't have nothing to hide. The hell with them. They can watch whatever they want. You understand? But we're going to build the image of an Israelite man. The image of an Israelite woman. That's what we are here to do. Build our nation back up with an image.
Exactly. And a little thing we got here, I'm sorry, with the food. That's one level. That's small. But that can be expanded. Yep. The little kitchen. Y'all got to see the vision of where that little kitchen can go to. Even the original words with the clothes. That can go to another level of what this Bible is saying. Y'all gotta see. You got to see the vision.
Right. What has to be grasped by the mind is that once that image, once the right image is put in your mind, Everything else before you has the potential of exponential growth. I'm serious. I don't even know if y'all understand what I'm saying. I'll give you an example. When we talk about the videos, the brothers coming in, sisters are coming in. That's just from the videos itself. They come in and they got X amount of talents. They begin to expand their particular talents. That's just one sister or one brother. As those particular talents are exponentially expanded, more people are catching on to each fringe of those particular talents. So it has the potential to go from 1 to 30, from 30 to 500. Okay, exactly. You got to look at things like that. So when you really understand it, the kingdom is ours. The kingdom is ours. The only thing that is stopping us is the number one tool that Esau uses, setting up headquarters in your head. Because once he stops you in the control seat, you're done. So having the tools to recorrect that head is the way we're going to get out of this mess.
Shalom, brothers, and shalom, sisters. I'm Elder Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. As many of you are finding out, Christianity has destroyed our people. For the past 400 years, we have been indoctrinated in lies. Those lies of Christianity have not benefited our people in the least bit. Many of you know this. So, like Christ said in John chapter 3, verse 3, he said, "Except ye be born again, you shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven." So in order to inherit the kingdom of heaven, which shall be established on earth, you must be born again. What does that mean? Many of you always quote that, but you don't understand what that means. When you go to 2 Ezra chapter 14, verse 34, Ezra said, "Therefore, if so be that ye will subdue your own understanding," meaning subdue all that you have learned here in Babylon the Great, it says, "and reform your hearts, ye shall be kept alive." What does that mean? Meaning you must be taught all over again, taught your nationality, taught why it is that we as a people went into slavery here in America. Who are we? What is the mystery of why this country, these nations have changed our nationality? We here at Israel United in Christ, we have classes 7 days a week, 3 times a day. All for what? For your learning, for your edification. You will learn things never taught to you before. You will learn history. You will learn prophecy. And more importantly, you will learn the dynamics of what you need today to survive as a people. 1/3 of Israel is prophesied to repent of their sins and come into this truth. So now we need you, brothers and sisters. Come, join us here at IsraelUnite.org. Go to our online classes and register. This is for you. This is for the redemption of the 12 tribes of Israel, brothers and sisters. I hope you understand that. Isaiah chapter 62, verse 6 says, "I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, keep not silent." And brothers and sisters, we are not keeping silence. So come join us. Help us build this truth. Donate to us so that we can keep this truth on and on. Push it forward. Help us get this gospel out. Because Christ said, when this gospel is taught throughout the earth, then shall the end come. So with that, brothers and sisters, we say shalom.